first stage here. It's 201 kilometres today, 125 miles, more or less. No climbs to upset the rhythm of the boys. And it's a circuit. We stay in Lecce while the riders go out and do a big lap of the hill. And the racing now underway. And it looks as though, in fact, all the lead out here is being done by the Demina Vacanzi team. So it looks as though Mario has got them on cue.
Well, these guys are the best drill squad in the world when it comes to leading out sprints like that. Look at that. All in a big long line. They're inside the final kilometre right now. Mario Cipollini is in an ideal position there in fourth place. There's a Frances de Jure rider getting involved there. I'm not quite sure who their top sprinter is. Getting up to his wheel, it looks like somebody from Fassa Bortolo. That's probably Alessandro Pataki. But Cipollini in an ideal position here.
Well, this is the big lead out. There's been little attacks all day for the 169 riders, but nobody going anywhere. Andris Noduks won the sprint out on the course. But now it looks as though they're all going to come around this one together. And I think that Giovanni Lombardi has hit the front there. He is the number one lead out man for the world champion, who's got his second place there. Pataki is on the wheel of... look at the face of Cipollini here. Now, this would be a record equal. If he can do it, it'll be his 41st stage win in a Giro d'Italia, and absolutely plenty of time to take the record off Alfredo Binder. Now he opens up for the line here, and it looks as though he's being challenged by Pataki. Little clash of shoulders, and Pataki's taken him. Well, I think, Paul, that's the first time Pataki has ever done that.
Well, he's always had a phobia about Mario Cipollini, but he put that behind him this afternoon. And look at that. It was a real challenge up to the line. Superb lead out by Giovanni Lombardi. Cipollini was in the ideal position, but he couldn't get by this man at all.
Well, is he happy? Alessandro Pataki, so often the bridesmaid to Mario Cipollini, has spoilt the thunder of the world champion there on the opening day of the Giro d'Italia. And congratulations due all round there by the look of it. Look at this now. This is the Italian frenzy at its best here, congratulating Alessandro Pataki. He's got tremendous form. This is his seventh win of the year. And the year, don't forget, has only been on a couple of months. Cipollini, I think he did it all right, and yet it just didn't have the speed at the end.
He even tried to close the gate just a little bit there on Alessandro Pataki, but the younger man, and I actually saw him earlier in the year win the opening stage of Paris-Nice, and he was very rapid there indeed. Cipollini, perfect lead out from his teammate there. I think he just got it wrong, and maybe it's age catching up with him, and possibly the weight of trying to equal the record of Alfredo Binder starting to weigh just a little bit heavily on his shoulders, Phil.
Well, Pataki himself now is almost 30 years of age. Now look at this, perfectly out. Lombardi did his job well, swung off to the left of our picture. May have swung off just a fraction early, I think.
It's like Graham Brown right in the middle as well in the orange jersey. He's a very good man. Saw him sprinting early on in the year in the Tour de Langkawi, and I think he was pretty raucous in the Tour Down Under in the first month of the season. But look at the face there on Alessandro Pataki. He wants to beat Mario Cipollini, and he's never been able to really do it in the past, and Cipollini, Phil, will not be happy with that.
No, he won't. It looked like Furlan. How would he be content there with third place? Well, he's going to milk this one for sure. Alessandro Pataki continuing what is for him a great start. He got his first win in the Trophy Lou Puig back in February. And there's confirmation of the result. It was Isaac Galvez Lopez from Kelme in fourth, McEwen fifth, and the other Aussie, Graham Brown, washed out to sixth. So a perfect start then for Alessandro Pataki. He gets the first Maglia Rosa of this tour, while Cipollini now knows he's got a real fight on his hands. Well, the sprinters might well be in play again today. This second stage going from Coppabini to Matera, 174 kilometres. We come off away from the heel of Italy now. A little bit of undulation, just a third category climb, the Monte Scaglioso. At 156 kilometres.
Shouldn't be much of a problem. There's a nice sight there of the pink jersey, Alessandro Pataki, lining up behind him, Robbie McEwen. So obviously McEwen knows which wheel he wants to follow this afternoon. And you can see the riders from Alessandro Pataki's team on the front, the Seiko riders moving forward as well, and I've not seen anything of Cipollini's boys right now. But right in there fighting is looks very much to me as if we've got one of Cipollini's men trying to sort him out. That, in fact, is Gabriele Colombo.
Well, Saeco have got obviously an interest here, and long-term candidate, says Gilberto Simoni, has made no secret that he comes here as a favourite, as there's an attack trying to get away, and that's Fredy González, I think, who's trying to get away. Well, he's had a good day so far because he was the first over the top of the climb, the third category climb out on the course, which will give him an early lead. No, it's Fortunato Baliani, in fact, who's gone across to Kelme now. It used to be on the Panaria team. Now, Baniali, he's not a bad sprinter, but he's an opportunist, really. He's not as a pure sprinter of the mould of Pataki or Cipollini or McEwen, or indeed his ex-teammate Graham Brown, and the pack are right behind.
There's a bit of confusion at the front end of this field right now. A lot of orange jerseys up there. There's the champion of Finland in there as well. But it's Pataki's men on the front. Pataki's bumping and barging a lot there in about fifth or sixth place. Looking a bit further down, I could see Robbie McEwen was also taking a few risks there, barging somebody, and it looks as if he was actually rubbing shoulders with Graham Brown.
Well, the Formaggio Pinzola rider, Baliani, just about hanging on now, but his days are numbered as they enter the last kilometre now. The sprinters again are going to clash here. Now, can Alessandro Pataki continue? Yesterday he was so confident. It's not as organised, this Paul, because the Demina boys are not well organised at all. I can't see any of them in sight. There's the pink jersey of Pataki, looking for the world champion's jersey of Mario Cipollini, and at the moment he's washed away from the scene here. This is going to be a very different type of sprint. It just shows you get your first big win in a stage race. Pataki's only ever previously won a couple of stages of the Vuelta, and now he's got all the confidence one requires, and he's perfectly lined up for this one yet again. Now Graham Brown once more is in on the action, still looking for the jersey of Mario Cipollini. It's not coming into my vision. Angelo Furlan is off to the left of the picture, and this is going to be a very, very tight sprint again. A perfect lead out, perhaps, as now there's a lead out here for Graham Brown as well, as they start on the right of the picture. And the lead out man for the pink jersey looking where he is. Now, he's still in fourth place there, and Cipollini looks as though he's been washed away from this. Now we're going to have to worry about Cipollini's form here. Graham Brown, I don't think, is going to make this, because the challenge from Robbie McEwen on the left, he's pushing a bit close there to Baldato. He gets it. McEwen has got it on the line, but I'm a bit worried there, Paul, because the hand went up of Fabio Baldato. Looks as though he's objecting.
Well, Fabio Baldato is a pretty experienced professional. He wouldn't do that if he didn't think that was a dangerous move. There's Robbie McEwen right in the middle. It looked to me like he was full on, but he did deviate from his line quite a bit in the last 200 metres. But, you know, sprinting is a dangerous part of the sport. You have to take risks. You have to see the opportunity when it jumps right in your face. And we'll have a look at that again. Let's have a look just from the helicopter here. There you can see on the right-hand side, Robbie McEwen really is going full on. He started the sprint in the middle of the road. And right now it looks to me as if he is closing the gate down on Fabio Baldato. Baldato, I'm not sure whether he could come through there or not. But I tell you what, at this sort of speed, you know, you're looking 40 miles an hour here right now, Fabio Baldato. And let's not forget, this is the Tour of Italy. Fabio Baldato is an Italian. He might just get the decision.
Well, amazingly, the rider behind there in the Domino Vacanzi is Gabriella Colombo. I'm very surprised that he came up for third place. Cipollini completely out of the hunt as we now look here at the move on the left, as it came clearly from Robbie McEwen, the big winner of last year. Had a wonderful season, ran out with more wins than anybody else. But he just senses there, you know, that he's running out of steam, and he's gently moving across to the right. And as we're watching this, I can tell you that they have disqualified McEwen from the win. He goes to the back of the race, and Baldato is the winner.
You know, that's a strange move there. I'm not sure if Robbie hadn't done that, I'm not really convinced that Baldato would have come through. He seemed to be moving up slowly alongside Robbie McEwen, but that's a question only he and Robbie McEwen will ever be able to answer. So Baldato there, a good man in his past, Phil. He's always been up there in races like the Tour of Flanders, but it doesn't do anything at all to change the overall classification, because it's still Alessandro Pataki on top.
And Pataki keeps the lead. Small time bonuses there, but nothing to affect at the moment. What has been a dream start after 2 days for Alessandro Pataki, as he gets the second Maglia Rosa of this tour at least. Just a few seconds in it in the overall classification now, as we move on to stage three. He leads by 4 seconds over Baldato and 19 over Gabriella Colombo. And the race now continuing here down the far south of Italy, from Policoro to Terme Lugiani. Chance now for a couple of climbs. There's the route contour for you. All the hills coming towards the end of the day, 145 kilometres.
Well, a tell you what, this is rather a difficult climb here on the running towards the finish, and it's going to catch one or two of the sprinters out by surprise, and it might give us our first chance to see a change in the overall classification. But I tell you what, as always, it's been very rapid over the last few kilometres trying to pick up the pace, and look how long that main field is, Phil. It's really been stretched out, and a little earlier on, Mario Cipollini was looking in a serious spot of bother at the back end of this field. I wonder if he has got the great form this year. And, you know, he's a special bike rider, Mario Cipollini. But look at this. This is a cheeky move. This is Robbie McEwen on the descent.
Well, I would not have expected McEwen to do this. Maybe he's still smarting after yesterday's disqualification from the win. He's going to take a few chances down here, though, because this is a tortuous descent. And watch out, because this is a tight left-hander here. McEwen safely through it, though. And continuing.
And now move. It's a strange move by Robbie, because he's actually in with the majority of the guys at the front end of this main field. I do believe that Mario Cipollini has been swept away from the front part of this group. And I tell you one thing, McEwen's lost all chances of winning now.
Yes, Cipollini has indeed been dropped. Last reported to be nearly 3 minutes behind this group. So the world champion not enjoying his opening days. And that record, all of a sudden, is on hold of Alfredo Binda. He's got 41 stages, and we've still got Cipollini sitting on 40. But I'm very surprised to see that Pataki's boys are still working hard here.
Well, Pataki's boys might be, but I think Domino Vacanze have decided they want to look after their young sprinter, Daniele Bernardi. He's well up there. We're inside the final kilometre right now, and it's either Bernardi they're going to look after, or it's Giovanni Lombardi. There's Pataki. He's got himself over the hill there, which is rather a surprise to me, because he has a bit of an allergy to these mountain passes, although they weren't that big this afternoon.
Well, we're gazing down through the grove of trees here from the helicopter, and we can see now that this is again going to be a very, very hard fought sprint. No Mario Cipollini, over 4.5 minutes back as we speak. After 3.5 hours now, the riders are still getting a perfect lead out, ironically, by Domino Vacanze, and Paul might be right. It may be for Bernardi today. Stefano Garzelli's down there as well. He's a rider that at this stage of the Giro last year was providing a positive dope test, controversially so, and was to be evicted from the tour later. But he's in the group down there now. Also, Alessio haven't yet picked out Robbie McEwen again.
Well, there you can see, just taking over the pacemaking right now. In fact, it is Lombardi who's on the front. He's definitely looking after Bernardi. None of the big sprinters are in here right now. They're in about fourth position. You can see Pataki. And watch out for a move there. You can see the lime green jerseys of Vinny Calderola. It could be a big surprise for Stefano Garzelli, because he does like a finish like this.
Well, this is a nice little group of riders here, and hats off to Pataki for surviving over the undulations and still be very much in with a shout, because there he is in third wheel here and getting a lead out from not his teammates, and he could well be saying in a moment, thank you very much indeed. Now, the rider in yellow, Vina Calderola, looks to me like Stefano Garzelli, not his style of a finish, but he's got the wheel of Pataki and he's going for it. Now, this would be a real surprise if Garzelli can do this, but it looks like at the end of what has been quite a tough day and brought this group down to a few riders, that is an inspired finish. And what a difference a year makes. Garzelli gets it, and Casagrande, I think, also got the better there of Alessandro Pataki.
That's an impressive move. Let's not forget, this guy's only been back in competition, Phil, I think, for not very much more than a week or 10 days. He won his first race back, and that was a stage of the Tour of Trentino, got himself up into second place in the overall classification. But from there to winning a stage of the Giro is unbelievable.
Well, it's good result for Garzelli, that, because he's still a pretty popular rider, and he'll have plenty to say to the press down there, I would think, after that win. And he's done it, don't forget, which will bring him right up the overall classification today. Cipollini way back now, as the race clearly split up on the run-in here today to this spa town.
Surprising, long actually time split Cipollini up that much. Yeah, I think Cipollini, the last check, was around about 2.5 minutes behind. But this is the final spurt up to the line here, and what a superb move here by Stefano Garzelli. Really was magical. There it was Casagrande on the far side there, and rather strange to see these two guys taking on the sprinters. And Pataki, well, hats off to him, Phil, because he's not reputed for being an uphill sprinter.
No, I'm quite surprised he even stayed with that sort of a quality group coming into the finish. He must have very good legs right now, Pataki.
He should keep
his Giamaglia Rosa, his pink jersey here, Paul, because I don't think Garzelli with that wind bonus can quite close the gap. I've got him back about 15 seconds or so.
And down there you can see this small stage has done an awful lot. In fact, that was Cipollini coming in. He had the blue jersey on there for the leader in the Intergiro competition. But no taking away the victory from this man, Stefano Garzelli. And a lot of people after that win will start to think that he will be a long-term favourite to try and win this bike race. But I think he'll probably crack in the last week, because after all, you can't have a year out of competition and come back in right at the top like that.
Well, at least that's what some of the big names are going to hope for. There's the overall situation. In fact, Garzelli up to second, 17 seconds. Casagrande, Colombo, Gilberto Simoni. These are big names here. Simoni, a previous winner of the Tour. Also not losing much time on these early stages, which of course is what they try to do with the mountains and the time trials still ahead. Pataki finishing well and keeps the lead on this race on points as well at the moment.
Well, this man is inspired. I really didn't think he'd get over that climb today. It was a very difficult climb and made much more difficult by the heavy tempo that these guys were putting on the front end of the peloton. Mario Cipollini certainly didn't like it.
So, as the race moves on, we can now have a look at the action on stage four. This will take the riders away from Luigiani to Vibo Valentia. 170 kilometres this one. And nothing really to upset the rhythm of the sprinters yet.
Well, it's all there down to the last part of the course. Those are not really very big climbs. You can see climbing up to around about 500 metres in altitude. But these coastal climbs really are the sort of climbs that the majority of the sprinters can get themselves over. And tomorrow the riders will be moving across to the island of Sicily. There's Mario Cipollini, 3 kilometres to go, and he's actually trying to battle his way back into the main field right now. And he really is not having a lot of luck here, Phil, in the Giro this year.
No, he's had a poor start, and it doesn't look as though he's got bad form. He may have just slowed down a little bit because he's found a rather superlative sprinter in Alessandro Pataki.
He's got a few of his teammates there, and he's inside of 3 kilometres to go. He's actually trying to get back onto the tail of the main field. He's got one or two teammates at the front. There is Giovanni Lombardi. He's riding at the front end of the main field, and he should, in fact, be back with Cipollini, trying to pace Cipollini back into the group. Cipollini, for the moment, 23 seconds off the tail end of the peloton.
Well, again, you see, he's not paying attention, or he's not got the legs. But look at these bunches down here now. Pataki is still the man to beat in this race as the riders now start to fan out.
McEwen going through there, 131. He's also trying to get himself up to the front end of the main field. As we look here, this will be 2 kilometres to go to the finish line.
Well, we had a long break all day by Alayo Adjano and Martin Vashtir. They've been caught now. It was a long, long break. But always to no avail when the sprinters start to lick their lips as the lead out starts now. And this is a good lead out here too. Looks like Matteo Brusagin, who's got the honour of being the one on the team this year for Fassa Bortolo. And there is Cipollini.
Well, he's getting close, but he's not going to close it down quite fast enough for the moment.
He
he's looking around for help.
He just lost it on that little climb, didn't he? And he just can't close it.
You know, he hasn't got the form, Phil. He just doesn't have it this year. I think maybe it's going to be the curse of the rainbow jersey once again. And it seemed so good for Mario Cipollini at the start of the season with some brilliant wins under his belt. And he actually looked to me as if he was going to do a good ride in Gent-Wevelgem. But right now, he's trying to pull himself back into the peloton. But this is pretty rapid on the front end of the main field. This is Alexis Rodriguez from Kelme. And this is rather surprising to see the Kelme boys doing such a big lead out like this. Pataki's in there. He's in there with the pink jersey in about 7th or 8th position. And then the next, well, there it is, 1,000 metres to go, the last kilometre.
Well, and the lead out is still there now for Alessandro Pataki. And this could be another win for this man who's starting to set this race alive. He's been defending that lead, as scant as it might be, for the Maglia Rosa as well, as the lead out begins now. But there's a good mixture of riders here at the front, as well as they're trying to find their way through this gap now. And the lead out has suddenly changed across now. It is no longer the team of Fassa Bortolo looking for the win here.
Well, Lombardi's right up there in about third position. He looks ideally in position to try and take up this sprint. Fabio Baldato's over there as well, but Pataki's too.
And that's we need a front shot now to see who's getting through there now, because McEwen is sitting back there in third wheel. Gaspari is also there and also making a run. I think it's Bernard Eisel who's also trying there for Française des Jeux. Very unusual this. Pataki's got the front though, and he's being challenged by McEwen, and he's got it. McEwen has gone over the top of Pataki. There are very few riders can do that. I think it was McEwen. If it was, it's his sixth win of the season.
Well, that was a pretty rapid. Well, oh. There it is from the side. You can see it's not very much, but it's enough to give Robbie McEwen, closest to us there, the victory by not much more than a quarter of a bicycle wheel.
Well, you don't get much closer than that, but pure sprinters will see that as a mile. And Robbie McEwen there getting his first win of the Giro d'Italia. And that win, by the way, should probably give him the lead of this race in the points department as well. We can see that again now. I'm very surprised that McEwen found the extra speed here, because when Pataki's been winning races this year, like Cipollini in the past, once he's got to the front, he usually holds it. But this time, McEwen just throws his bike.
I tell you what, he was using a monster gear there as well, and that's something he certainly wanted to do. A bit of sweet revenge from just a couple of days ago when he was disqualified for putting Fabio Baldato into the barriers. Robbie McEwen will be happy with that win on stage number four. It'll be a different ball game tomorrow as the riders go across to the island of Sicily, because there's quite a big climb in the middle of that stage.
Now there's the overall very briefly for you. 29 seconds. Garzelli, no change there. No change at all in the top three places. Casagrande hanging on. And Pataki still the only leader of this race as we now move on towards Cantaria, which is stage number five. This one's 169 kilometres now as we continue on. They're staying in what is ideal racing conditions just at the moment for the riders. Second category climb on this route takes up to 1,125 metres. It's about 3,700 feet.
This is a stage that Mario Cipollini felt that he could win, Phil, but I do think that that little pimple in the middle there is going to be just a bit too hard for Mario Cipollini, because he doesn't seem to have the climbing legs right now.
No, and as we catch up with the action here now, that little pimple was won by Fredy González early on from Luis Laverde and Rinaldo Lottentini. They covered 60 kilometres today in the first 2 hours, so very sedate start for the riders. But now, of course, we're coming down towards the finish as the riders now looking for the next big sprint as they're moving on down the way now. Let's have a look at the line-out. Again, now there's Cipollini, Paul, and he's five or six man down. Now, has he got it right today?
Well, he said he wanted to win this one. I can't believe he was able to get over that climb here this afternoon. He's got the team up there in front of him. And in fact, again, it looks like Baliani's decided to try and outfox everybody there, jumping through the inside. This man has caused a bit of confusion, but not to the super lead-out team of Domina Vacanze. The team that Mario Cipollini has built around him over the last few years. Cipollini's in an ideal position there, queuing up into fourth place. They go around that corner, very tricky move there. Somebody's gone off, and that was somebody went down very rapidly there. That was one of the CCC Polsat riders. I think he was taking a few too many risks, but the front runners have gone through nice and clean. Graham Brown is up there as well.
It could well have been actually also Brent Lancaster down, and it might have been Nasdux, but that was a nasty prang there. But out of the race, just on the last kilometre to go. Cipollini now, remember, a win today will equal Alfredo Binder, but he's got the wheel of Pataki.
Well, this is the wrong way around. Cipollini should be on his own teammate here right now, but his guys, they know exactly what to do. They'll put Pataki into difficulty. We've seen him do that so many times before. What they have to do, if they want to make Pataki lead out from a long way, is pull off early, and then we still have Mario Cipollini in an ideal position to take up the pace. That's Leo. This is Giovanni Lombardi in first place, Pataki second, Cipollini third.
Lombardi, quite frankly, is leading out at the worst possible man for this, because Pataki has got the wheel of Lombardi. He's going to thank him for this. Cipollini gambling. He is a much faster finisher than Pataki, because now it's going to go mano a mano. That's Bernard Eisel in third place, but on the jump he lost a length, and Pataki is opened up. Now here comes Cipollini giving his best shot. Cipollini hasn't got it on the line. He's lost again. And this time, Pataki is going to increase his overall lead as well. He gets a 20-second win bonus for that. He won't believe the way he's starting this year's Giro d'Italia. He's been the only leader so far, 5 days into the race.
This is a man, Phil, until this year had a complex about Mario Cipollini. He did not believe he had the ability to beat Super Mario. And now he's done it there. He did it fair and square. He led Cipollini out. Look at this. Hugging the barriers nice and tight there on the right-hand side. Cipollini gets a perfect lead out from one of the fastest men in the world right now, Alessandro Pataki. Cipollini comes up alongside. And, you know, it looks to me as if this is the moment Cipollini's about to pass. And there's a slight movement in his pedalling action there, just about 50 metres to go. You see, I think he might have hit something in the road. And then in the lunge for the line, it was not very much at all.
Well, we'll have a look if we get a head-on shot, but they could have hit a hole in the row, but there's no doubt who won. Pataki over Cipollini, Eisel, Moreni, McEwen, Brown, Zvereda, all the big sprinters right behind, but really not in the hunt at all. Just watch for that as he comes up in his front shot then, because Cipollini looked to have the speed here. He certainly made the right move coming off his wheel early enough, and I really thought he was going to take this.
Well, he was moving up all of the time. These men were both going at it in 53 pocket on the outside and 11 on the inside, and it looked as if there was a moment there when Cipollini hit something and lost a bit of momentum, but there was no problems and no mistakes for Alessandro Petacchi, who's this year turning out to be the dominator of Mario Cipollini.
And he still leads the race, increased now with that twin bonus of 20 seconds over Stefano Garzelli. 49 seconds the advantage. Casagrande stays there in third. Pelizzotti comes up into fourth place. He's leading in just about all of the competitions at the moment. He's got his points jersey back as well off Robbie McEwen. And so he's just got head of the leaderboard in the points and in the race lead, and he's won the stage. He's really doing just about everything right. The King of the Mountains at the moment still being led by Fredy González. Onwards we go now, a chance to look at stage number six, from Maddaloni to Avezzano. One of the longest stages here at 222 kilometres. And this is going to be a race of undulating countryside, quite pretty countryside now, as we start to begin our journey a little bit north.
Well, a bit more difficult as well as they start to head into the middle of the peninsula, because these roads will be heavy. There's one or two climbs on the course, but once you start to get away from the coast, Italy is a very difficult cycling country.
And Cipollini still in the mix today. There hasn't been any attack of note. There was a long breakaway of three. Christian Moreni as a buyer of the Kelme team, and Magnus Bäckstedt of the Fakta team is also sprinting very well at the moment, but they've been swept up. And now it looks like Mario Siria, who is the lead out man. There's Eisel. Eisel is sprinting very, very well for FDJ, Francais du Jeu, at the moment, but there's an awful lot of the zebras around.
There are. You can see Mario Cipollini's up there, and I think in the back of his mind right now, Phil, he must be starting to get a bit worried about his form, because he's been beaten to the line quite sensibly a couple of times by Alessandro Petacchi. And Petacchi this time is taking up the wheel of Cipollini. There's Cipollini. Big bike rider he is, but once he gets a crack at the line, he really knows how to open up the gas. Right in front of him is the final lead out man for him, Giovanni Lombardi. They seem to put all their problems behind. Cipollini complaining a couple of days ago that Giovanni didn't wait for him when Cipollini was only 20 seconds off the back end of the main field. There's the pink jersey, though. There's no problems about him.
The pink jersey, once you've got the lead and you're winning stages, you don't need any more confidence than that. Just trying to tag on to the back wheel of the pink jersey is the other good sprinter on Kelme, Isaac Galvez Lopez. He's been sprinting very well, just on the second rank, if you like, of the sprinters at the moment. And winging round the corner there, Graham Brown. He's overdue for a win, I think.
Well, Brownie's been pretty close all the time. The amazing thing about Brownie is he can come from a long way back. Look at this, Domino Vacanzi. They've got four riders still left at the front. And the fourth rider is Mario Cipollini. Moving up onto his wheel was the pink jersey of Alessandro Petacchi. A couple of points back there was Graham Brown. Brownie will be looking to try and get himself up there. He's actually lost a bit. There's Brown in fifth. Last kilometre now.
Ongarato, Bernardi, the first two riders under the banner, and it looks as though Cipollini has got it organised now. They've got so far away here, there'll be a split time on the line as well, and Petacchi is out to increase his overall lead. He's hooked up to the back wheel of the world champion, but at last it looks as though Cipollini has organised right the Dominia Vacanzi team, because he's got them all going at the front.
Yeah, there's some big names missing though. There was a Saeco rider just sat up there. He's looking for Gilberto Simoni. He's going to lose himself a bit of time here this afternoon. There's Jan Verada as well, the rider in there for Lampre.
Well, the speed has split the race here, and I don't think there was a crash down the back, but it looks to me as though this group has got itself clear.
Oh my God, Zelli's on the back there. I can't believe that. This man may be moving up high in the overall classification with a move like this, because soon we'll get into the big hills, and that's a good move for him over the rest of the challenge. But this is Lombardi on the front, Cipollini in an ideal position.
And that's Isaac Galvez on the left, who's taking on Petacchi. Cipollini sat up. Cipollini has sat up. Petacchi is going to get win number three. Easy as you like. Well, I can't believe that. I don't quite know why Cipollini sat up, unless he felt he was beaten just before the line. But you see, the main field here gets a separate time, 3 or 4 seconds.
You know, I actually think his teammates might have asphyxiated him. They pushed him so hard. They did a perfect lead out. They gave it full on for the last 3 kilometres. And it may well be that Cipollini, when he came to the moment, he got out of the saddle to start the sprint. There was nothing there. You can do nothing to stop this man here, though, right now. Alessandro Petacchi, for an Italian in the Giro d'Italia, Phil, this is a dream come true. This doesn't happen. This is magic.
Well, and the man also saluting there was Marco Velo, who really saw all of the hard work pay again. Huge dividends here. three stage wins now, and this race only on stage number six. Half of them are going the way of Alessandro Petacchi, who will increase his lead both on points and on the race time overall. There's the result. Galvez getting second place. Jan Zverev, his best finish so far. Velo punching the air. He came over in fourth place. Just look at the speed of Petacchi. Galvez went with him. That was a good move, but it did. He had no chance of actually beating him.
Perfect lead out here, though. Look at this. Giovanni Lombardi on the front there. And as soon as Cipollini looks across, he can see, he can probably feel Alessandro Petacchi's acceleration. But if you look at the face there on Mario Cipollini, yeah, he gets out of the saddle and sits back down again straight away. I don't think he had it this afternoon, and I wonder if he's actually going to equal that record of Alfredo Binder right now. It seemed obvious at the start of the Giro that he was going to walk away with the record if he showed the dominance of last season, but maybe the curse of the rainbow jersey is going to stop him from doing that.
Well, you've got to see there that he could not lift himself any quicker. Petacchi, very, very quick indeed. And this was one of his easier wins, in all honesty, and it was the Dominia Bacanti team that led him out. He's now increased his lead to a minute and 9 seconds, had two win bonuses in 2 days, that's 40 seconds in themselves. Casagrande third, Pellizzotti, no change there, Simoni up in, in fifth place. But the Maglia Rosa is beginning to look nice. Not that he's anticipating winning the Tour of Italy, but he's going to keep that lead as long as possible.
But I think what's interesting is that split towards the end. Stefano Garzelli was very attentive.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Anyway, the riders now can enjoy the next stage, which will take us on to the seventh day of racing as we look out across some of the higher climbs now as we head up the Terminillo and this 146 kilometres.
Well, it's the first taste these riders will have had of the big mountains this year in the Giro, and it's certainly going to be a very difficult stage. All of these riders know the Terminillo. It's a very difficult climb, moving away from Avezzano. It undulates in the first part of the course, and then once they get up around Rieti, then it's the big climb up towards the finishing line.
Well, as expected, we're not going to see much of Alessandro Petacchi now, a week in the lead, and this is certainly one stage he is not going to win. As we look down on a very select little group here, as the climb starts, Francesco Castagrande is there, sitting off to the left. This could now be the first big selection of this year's Giro.
Pantani in a bit of difficulty, but I'm surprised to see how well he's actually surviving for the moment. His team have been all around him, as always, dedicated to just one thing, keeping Marco Pantani at the front end of the main field. He's a very popular bike rider despite the ups and downs in his career. They certainly love him at the side of the road here in Italy. But this is the man who I think has probably got the best chance of winning the Giro d'Italia this year, Francesco Casagrande. He's got his teammate up there alongside him. In fact, he's been put into difficulty here right now. He's supposed to be the team leader, and in fact, he's scrambling back up to the front.
The Seiko rider he's riding with there, Leonardo Bertagnoli, also sitting just behind as this little group is in a little bit of pressure. Also riding there with him is Vladimir Belli. And he is a good climber. He has his moments, Vladimir Belli. Here comes Marco Pantani, sitting just behind Marco Pantani. Is the Kelme rider, that's Carlos Garcia. Pantani desperate to try and prove that he hasn't lost those magic legs that used to take him over the mountains. But Garzelli is coming through best just now. Got Simoni just behind him here.
And Eddie Mazzolini just in front of him. On the far side in the Alessio jersey is Andrea Noe. And that looks like Raimondas Rumšas now. He's supposed to be looking after Casagrande. Casagrande will not be happy with that at all. And there too is Tonkov, the leader of this very new CC Polsat team.
Tonkov has had a love affair with the Giro d'Italia for many years. He's had places, he's had the win. He's had seconds, thirds, fourths, fifths. It is an incredible career record in the Giro d'Italia for Pavel Tonkov, and he's going again today.
Just on the back of that group as well, Oscar Pellizzotti. But look at this, and we're also, for the first time in the Giro, experiencing the hats-off rule as well. This is the first time that we've been subjected to this rule. A new rule in international cycling is you have to wear helmets on all occasions, except on a mountaintop finish where the climb exceeds 5 kilometres or 3 miles. And most of these riders were pretty happy, Phil, with the temperature here this afternoon to get rid of those hats pretty rapidly at the bottom.
Well, these are hot days, and this now is the first real big challenge of this year's Giro. And one or two riders are beginning to look as though they're lacking just a little bit. Marco Pantani dangling just off the back of the senior part of the race at 10 kilometres to go. All the way to the top now. That's Pellizzotti, who's tagged onto the back. He was once the young rider of the year in Italy.
Yaroslav Popovych has got in there as well, the rider from Lambeau Credit. Quite a surprise rider last year in the Giro d'Italia, who rode very high in the overall classification, and he's joined this very select group of men right now. A little further back, there's our friend, the great Mexican climber from Panaria. He's moving up towards the front end of this group. And Julio Perez, well, he seems also to have been put under pressure right now as well, Phil. That's a surprise. Maybe because it's the first big mountain of the Giro, a lot of these riders struggling to find their first rhythms.
Well, it does happen, and after a week of fast racing, we've had just the one rest day, the riders are now finding that this is the part where you can gain huge chunks of time. Pataki, by the way, is well out of the hunt.
And was that Scott Sunderland in that group as well? That I saw one of the Factor riders just sitting on the back of the group, and I think it might be the Australian Scott Sunderland who's managed to get himself right to the front end of this bike race here.
Scott's had an up-and-down career, and he's now hopefully on his way back yet again. A lot of work here being done here. Garzelli, for me, is looking the danger. That's Eddie Mazzolini who's doing the pacemaking. Cerrone is in this group, just up here, and that is Andrea Noe. Another man, Noe, who turns out ride after ride, but only in the Giro d'Italia.
He's a brilliant bike rider, but he's one of those riders too who you actually never really see, but he's always there and ends up getting himself high finishes in the overall classification. It is Scott Sunderland, and in fact, he's not far away from Marco Pantani, and I bet Scotty Sunderland never would have thought that he'd be riding the mountains with Il Pirata himself. Trying to move across there, that looked like Francesco Casagrande is not enjoying this climb at all. But Scott Sunderland, Phil, as you said, he's had a very up and down career, had some nasty accidents. He really is riding superbly here right now. And Team Factor, one of the teams looking to possibly get themselves a wildcard selection for the Tour de France.
Well, Scott Sunderland's going to take a lot of strength from the fact he's riding alongside Marco Pantani here. And still Mazzolini pacing Garzelli. Garzelli and Simoni are the big scorers here today. Tankoff should be included in that comment as well, I think. Likely riders to win this race. They've all won the Tour before. They're all in this leading group at the moment. The dark horse is Raimondas Rumšas. We didn't expect to see him here, but here he is. And also the younger Yaroslav Popovych is down there as well for the Lambeau Credit Team.
Well, this is a great job of work on the front there being done by Eddie Mazzolini. And looking at this group right now, because of that move yesterday with a big split towards the end, it could well put Stefano Garzelli in a position to take the overall lead. But I would think there will be a challenge come from Gilberto Simoni, because this is his kind of climb.
Well, we've lost Casagrande, and so the next candidate now is undoubtedly Stefano Garzelli, to put him back into the pink where he was last year, remember, when he was in disgrace in the Giro. Kicked off it in the end, controversially so, but he's back again now. This is further down the road, belly on the right, leading this group is Marco Pantani, and Scott Sunderland tucked in there as well.
On the back there, Marco Velo as well, a former teammate of Marco Pantani, now riding for the big Fassa Bortolo squad. Pantani losing not very much more than about 25 seconds for the moment. There is Francesco Casagrande. He's in difficulty. He's also there, I think, in contact with Pavel Tonkov. But Marco Pantani, Phil, actually seems to be riding himself back into this group as we go inside of 9 kilometres to go to the summit. 9 kilometres, that's still about 25 minutes of racing.
Yeah, that's right. And he's got a strange pedaling style, Pantani. If he catches left the way, he ankles on the bike. He's in the next group, of course, but back up with the leaders here. This is a rather select group now. Pavel Tonkov, Eddie Mazzolini, Andrea Noah, Simoni, Garzelli, Sabalioskas, he's the big tall guy from Saeco, and Rumšas, Pelizzotti, Popovich. Look at the face there of Marco Pantani. Boy, that's hurting, but he's still going. You can see his pedaling action now, very pointed toes, a little bit like Jacques Anquetil in the years gone by.
Tell you what, nobody could say Marco Pantani wasn't trying there. What a great job of work, though, by Eddie Mazzolini. This is Julio Perez, the great Mexican climber, was superb last year, but this year he hasn't got it just yet. But let's not forget, there's a lot more mountains to come in the Giro d'Italia. Just round the corner there is the group they are all trying to get into contact with. Popovich here, Phil, at the back. He was 12th overall in the Giro last year and a former world road race champion in the under 23 level of the sport. He's a great revelation, and he's a certain credit to this team anyway, Lambeau Credit, one of the small teams on the block. But to have a man in a leading group like this when you've got a small team is really good for the morale of the troop.
He's still only 23. He's got everything to race for in the years ahead here. Pataki, by the way, this is Aitor Gonzalez, who won the Tour of Spain on a different team. He was for Kelme last year. I think he's going to be a bit disappointed by the situation at the moment, because whereas we've had Pataki in the pink all week, when the pink jersey moved on, I think Fassa Bortolo thought it might move towards Aitor Gonzalez. Not so. He looks as though he's really in quite a bit of difficulty here on the first major ascent of this year's Giro d'Italia. Pantani is riding himself. I don't think it was through a bad patch. I think he was just a little bit slow to get himself into a climbing rhythm. But he is now riding very well indeed.
Just a little bit difficult as you get older in years to be able to respond to the accelerations, the changing in rhythm on these climbs like this. There is the man who is looking to try and do something later on in this climb there, Simoni, in third position, sitting right on the wheel of Stefano Garzelli. Garzelli on the comeback trail, 12 months out of competition, a little further back, around about 25 seconds to Marco Pantani. In that group there with Vladimir Belli, as we swing up with the magic of television to see the group in between. That's the group of Francesco Casagrande. There he is. He's doing all of the pacemaking on the front. And I bet he won't be very happy, Phil, about the fact that Raimondas Rumšas is in the group in front, because before the start of the Giro d'Italia, Francesco Casagrande was regarded as the number one leader for Team Lampre. And the way it works in Italian teams is if you're the leader, everybody else has to help you and wait for you.
That's Tochnik down there, by the way, on the back wheel of Perez, who just seems to be closing the gap now. Julio, he was disappointed to be on the defensive on this climb, because he was actually planning a high finish in the Giro this year, and as a result of that was saying he wasn't going to contest the King of the Mountains competition. He wanted more of an overall result, yet he's been split on this climb as well. One or two riders getting caught out today. Let's have another little look here at Marco Pantani as he continues on the climb. Not too sure why our producers are showing us the slow motion here, other than to see the great man in action as we leave him behind now, looking back up with the leaders here now. And Garzelli, the second man here, he only had a couple of weeks to prepare for this. His suspension only ended last month, and he really has had to work. But he says, even though he hasn't been racing, he's been simulating racing throughout the training he's been doing, and treating each of his training rides as if he was in a road race.
It really is quite remarkable what he's done, because he's actually taken his diary from previous years and tried to ride exactly the same number of miles at exactly the same intensity on every individual day. And that takes an unbelievable amount of mind-bending to be able to do that. Aitor Gonzalez, regarded as a pre-race favourite, winner of the Vuelta a España last year, was brought onto this team to lead them in the three-week Grand Tours. But right now, he's having a bit of bother there. Trying to get onto the back there, look like Steve Zampieri. He's a good man when it comes to the big mountains. But this is the leading group right now, Eddie Mazzolini. Eddie Mazzolini's always ridden very well in the Giro d'Italia, and look at this is the move now. This looks like Simoni wants to blow this race apart, because he said to his teammate in there, come up, let's turn up the screws right now, and he moves up into command.
Well, there's one or two lacking. Rumšas got caught, and so did Pelizzotti with the acceleration. Young Popovych just about hung on to the back of that group. Three, six, seven of them now trying to push for the summit. And former winner Gilberto Simoni is the man hurting the most.
Well, he wants this. He loves uphill finishes. He really does excel when it comes to putting the hammer down. Julio Perez, I don't think he's going to catch up here this afternoon. The difference you see, Phil, between being an unmarked rider going out for individual stages, then trying to ride high in the overall classification. It puts an awful lot more pressure on a bike rider, not just physically, but psychologically. There is Francesco Casagrande a bit further down. And he's really just trying to pull himself back into this bike race, and he will be rather surprised about his form moving forward there. Pavel Tonkov has actually left Francesco Casagrande behind, and a bit further back will we get a chance to see. Yes, there he is, Marco Pantani, Scott Sunderland, and Aitor Gonzalez.
Well, the pink jersey of Pataki, we saw it said goodbye to him just before the 20-kilometre marker to go today. So he's losing time, and because it's all of this slog uphill, I think he'll lose quite a lot of time. He won't fight to defend or even stay near the top of the leaderboard now, I wouldn't think.
Well, that was a nice sight there, just in that blue jersey, just pacing his teammate there. That was for Charlie Wagelis, the English rider. So Charlie's doing a pretty good ride on this climb.
Well, Well, we've got great hopes for Charlie. He's a lanky rider, very thin legs, very tall, but extremely strong in the mountains he loves.
And the team captain he was looking after there was Sergei Gonchar of the small Dinardi Colpack team.
Well, that's his leader, isn't it? He's supposed to ride with him as long as he can.
But at the moment it was actually Charlie who was pacing his leader. Now then, we're looking further up the road now at the leading group, and it's complete control for Team Saeco. This is Gilberto Simoni in second position. He'll use his teammate for as long as possible, and I wouldn't be surprised, Phil, if we don't see an attack coming from Simoni in the last 3 or 4 kilometres there. And a little bit more intensity coming into the pedalling action of Stefano Garzelli. Eddie Mazzolini, well, he's just hanging on. He's done a lot of work for the team, and Rumšas has pulled himself back into this group with the Marco Pantani group right now, we're being told, a minute and 13 seconds in arrears.
Fredy González is still in the lead in the King of the Mountains, but he's not in our picture at the moment. He got a third place over the first, second category climb of the day, and that might be enough to keep him in the Green Point Mountains leader's jersey, but he's not in this group at all right now, as we're looking at the work being done here now. And there's the acceleration by Simoni. It's the second time he's tried that, but look at the rapid response coming from Garzelli. He really is paying attention just now.
Yeah, look at that. Tonkov has come back into the group as well, so I'm not sure what happened to Tonkov in the early part of the climb, but I think he was able to just ride at his own rhythm, accelerate slowly and bring himself back into this bike race. But I don't think Simoni expected the reaction there to come from Stefano Garzelli. Right onto their wheel is Andrea Noen. Let's look at this one more time. He wanted this. He loves accelerating on a climb when he can, and out of the saddle he's used his teammate Salviuskas as much as possible. But Stefano Garzelli was right there.
He was almost waiting. He almost sensed that move was coming, maybe because he saw the 1-2 of Saeco on the front. Remember, Saeco having a marvellous season. And they've had a wonderful start to the year. They've placed well in the classics. They've won one of the Flèche Wallonne as well. They've done well, second place in Milan San Remo. This is a great season for them at the moment. And Pavel Tonkov is just hovering here. Is he going to come back? I think he will. Simoni has hurt everybody else except Garzelli.
Well, Andrea Noe has gone with that final acceleration. Look at that, Stefano Garzelli. Tonkov has gone right now, and so too has Andrea Noe. This is the second kick for Gilberto Simoni. He really is a tough competitor, Phil. He's a tough bike rider. He wants to win this on his own. He won't be too happy right now having somebody sitting on his wheel, especially when that young man's name is Stefano Garzelli, because he knows Garzelli can be a serious threat. I don't think a long-term threat, because having such a long time out of competition, you certainly don't have the reserves when it comes to a three-week bike race. As we now look at Andrea Noe, look at this, Phil. He's pulling himself back up to the wheel of Tonkov, and while further down, his teammate Pelizzotti also is riding himself back into this bike race. This man here, by the way, is a very talented bike rider. He's got a problem with his knee right now. You can see that slight bandage on the left-hand knee that he's got. But we now are looking at this race with just two leaders, Stefano Garzelli, a former winner of the Tour of Italy, and Gilberto Simoni with the same tag.
Early days, of course. We're coming to complete the first 7 days of racing in the Giro of the 21 stages, one third over. And these two riders are certain now, if things stay as it is, to become the top two in the overall classification. And it'll be, even if Garzelli can win here, he's got a slight advantage over, or not win, if he doesn't win, he'll still have a lead, I think, over Simoni. He's got just a little bit too much to, for the time bonuses not to matter. He should be racing now to the pink jersey. We've got no news at all on Pataki, but he's quite a way down this mountain.
Well, Andrea Noe this year in the Giro d'Italia being able to ride for himself very much, because he's at a team that has no real leader. They've got Pietro Caucchiole, they've got Pelizzotti, but nobody is head and shoulders above the rest. So maybe Andrea Noe can get his highest ever position in the Giro d'Italia this year. Look at the damage that this climb has done, though, as we rejoin the two leaders. Garzelli's just got to sit there as long as he can, ensure that there's going to be another acceleration coming from Gilberto Simoni, and all he has to do is try and respond to all of those. The gradient on this climb is not so bad. It was around about 10% at the early part of the climb, and it actually gets easier as you get closer to the summit. And it's always always makes me laugh, Phil, when in a commentary position we can say the climb gets easier towards the top.
Yes, quite. Well, these are the riders who won, have each won the Tour. Last year's winner, Paolo Savadelli, not here. Switch teams member, gone across now to Telecom and looking for him for the Tour de France. But these are the two previous winners to that. Savardelli winning last year, but Simoni winning in 2001 and Garzelli in 2000. That really did accelerate him as a top man in Italian cycling.
Briefly there, group number three on the road, Rumšas, Popovych working together, but the two leaders are really being subjected to the dominance here of Gilberto Simoni. Simoni, by the way, won that Giro del Trentino that Stefano Garzelli won the opening stage of not much more than about 10 days ago. And I tell you what, he would really like to get rid, I think, of the man who is with him in this group. He'd like to get hold of the pink jersey right here, right now, right this afternoon, if he can. But he's got to do one thing if he wants to get the pink jersey at the summit of this climb: get rid of that man. While further down the slope, this is Marco Pantani, and he's got a very good teammate with him, by the way. This is a young Polish rider, Sylvester Schmidt, who I actually didn't know anything at all about before the start of this year's Giro d'Italia.
Well, they're quite a way down the climb now. Simoni looks, now he's split the field up. He's doing all of the work. Garzelli just sitting there behind him and knowing that Simoni can tow him all he likes, because he'll be the next recipient of the Maglia Rosa, and then he'll have to defend it.
But the gap is not great over Tonkov there. Do you see the time check was just 6 seconds? So although he had the initial burst, he's actually not doing the job of building on that gap that he started to do just around the corner there. Noe now has left Tonkov, and Tonkov has been left behind there in front of the cars. Noe is going to ride himself back into this race. He's a great biker. He won't give up at all when it comes to the Giro d'Italia.
I think this is the only time of the year we ever commentate on Andrea Noe. He really is an amazing bike rider. He finished fourth in 2000, sixth in 2001, and 20th last year in the Giro d'Italia. And he's right in the frame again, and he's coming back slowly but surely. There's no doubt that Simoni, having split the field up, has not put home the advantage here, whether it's because he can't or whether he's just easing it back to see what Garzelli's going to do about it. Well, only time will tell us there.
Well, you look at his pedalling action right now. He looks as if he's having a hard time pushing a big gear over on the slopes of this climb, and this gives you a chance to see the return on the right-hand side of Andrea Noe. He's just looking at those two cars in front of him. Those will be the team cars of Simoni and Garzelli. He'll set his eyes on those and just hope that he can pull it all back together before the finish. What a finish that would be if he could get himself the stage victory. Tonkov is a strange rider, Phil. Whenever you look at him, he never looks as if he's suffering. He's rock solid on the bike. His pedaling action is always smooth. His face never gives anything at all away.
And he's not even looking at Garzelli, is he? He's not saying, come on, Stefano, give us a hand here. You've got as much to gain as I have. He's just sitting there. Now they're going virtually side by side as they head up towards the summit.
I reckon Garzelli's probably suffering here right now. This is a moment he just wants to come up alongside Gilberto Simoni and say, well, you've given me your best shot and I'm still here, so if you've got anything left, just open up the gas one more time, because I'm not going anywhere, mate. I'm going to stay right here with you. But it's hurting him. Just look at his face here. It really is remarkable, Phil. Whatever you think about what happened last year to Stefano Garzelli in the Giro d'Italia and that positive dope test for a now defunct masking agent called probenecid, he still has come back to the top of the sport after 12 months without competition, and that is pretty remarkable.
That's right. Simoni himself having his own clash with the authorities too, with the famous sweets which contained cocaine. Simoni's case was proven, and all penalties were absolved. He did win in his appeal, but now they're both here to prove a point. They're side by side, the two previous winners of Giro d'Italia, and they're now trying to sort it out amongst themselves, while Andrea Noe, if our camera swung around, cannot be far behind.
He's right on the tail of the two service cars following these two men right now. This is a very big psychological battle. This is what the front end of the race looks like. But look there on the right-hand side, number eight, Andrea, new leaders who thought they were going to decimate the... I tell you what, though, Garzelli is pulling himself inside out to stay here with Simoni, Phil. He's probably breathing out of his left ear so that Simoni can't see that he's putting himself into problems.
Andrea Noe, his greatest moment, probably in 1998 when he won a stage of the tournament, then not too far off this one. He also wore the pink jersey briefly, but since then he's had a real good love affair with this race. Now, did you see the stare then from Simoni?
That was a stare, just to see what was going on in the eyes of Stefano Garzelli. But this man, number eight, Andrea Noe, used to ride for Mappe. His job was to look after men like Pavel Tonkov when they were all together on the Mappe squad, and if he's got anything in his legs right now, he needs to hit them hard, and that will psychologically hurt them.
I don't think he can accelerate. He's come up here and he's latched on. Simoni will know he's there soon. Let's see what he does about it. He's going right up onto the shoulder of Gilberto here as we head towards the summit of the Terminillo. And it's going to be a three-man sprint for the honour. And I would think that these three riders will go 1-2-3 in the overall classification. Probably in the order Garzelli, Simoni, Noe, because that's how it is in the time gains at the moment.
I tell you, the remarkable thing to me is the fact that Stefano Garzelli is still there, because that lack of competition is so difficult to replace. And right now, we know Simoni's had a pretty good start to the season with his win in the Tour of Trentino. But he has also taken part in most of the other preparation races as well. This is the next group on the road. That's Popovych. Eddie Mazzolini's not going to help them at all. And he, because he's got his team leader, Stefano Garzelli, just up the road, seeing the Flamme Rouge, the kites that indicate. Noe, Phil, what a great ride. And it would be great for him to try and get the stage victory. But he's going to have a hard time, because the two men that he's with, when it comes down to accelerating at the top of mountains, they're both pretty good.
I can't see him, even though he's here, getting any better than third. But even so, he's done well to climb up to these two. Nobody else has been able to achieve that all day. He's 34 years of age now, Andrea Noe. Turned pro a long time ago in 1993. So this will be, what, his 11th season as a pro.
Well, just a few moments just to go, but that's the 2 kilometre to go banner just down there. As in fact, it looks as if somebody else is riding themselves back into this bike race. A couple of years ago was regarded, and this is the time when Gilberto Simoni says, well, that's it, finished with the playing, lads, let's get on with the job in hand.
Ouch.
And he's out of the saddle and he's put Noe back into problems.
Ouch, that really has hurt Noe. He hadn't recovered from the chase, he's opened it again, but you know, it's almost as if Garzelli's got his bike hooked up onto the saddle of Simoni, because he hasn't given him a millimetre. He's right up on his back wheel, and that's put a couple of seconds back now into Andrea Noe. And there's a second acceleration from Simoni. Surely Noe's not going to come back from this, but he's still ahead of the rest, and he'll hang on for third place. And now, looking around to see where he's gone, is Garzelli. Garzelli, too, is on his absolute maximum. That was Tonkov briefly.
He's on the rivet, and there a bit further back was Pellizotti. You see the difference in the pedalling style of these two men. You see on the inside there, Gilberto Simoni, the climber, is out of the saddle, bouncing all the time, dancing on those pedals to try and keep them ticking over, where on the other point, you look at Stefano Garzelli. He sits a long way back on the saddle, well behind the bottom bracket. That way he can climb on force, as they say in the old cycling jargon. And again, he pulls up alongside Gilberto Simoni, man against man here right now. 10 seconds back to the Tonkov group and 32 seconds back to the Raimondas Rumšas group. And we're not getting any time checks at all right now on Francesco Casagrande, who to me, before the start of the Giro, was the number one favourite to win, because he's got the best form of his life.
I know, I can't believe it. He's had a terrible climb. We saw him fading early on. He was dropping behind Marco Pantani when we last saw him, and it looks as though it may be nerves, who knows, but he certainly hasn't had a good...
This is great. This is good stuff for Andrea Noe. What a man. He cannot respond to the accelerations of Gilberto Simoni, but once they get the gap, I think they're actually playing a bit of a tactical game here. They're not quite sure just how good the other one is. Gilberto Simoni has attacked 3 or 4 times really hard to get rid of Stefano Garzelli. And every time Garzelli has stayed there up alongside him, Andrea Noe says, well, you guys go and play and I'll come back when you slow down.
Well, he's keeping his rhythm. He's finding his own climbing pace. Climbers do not like other climbers to dictate how they climb. You've got to find your own rhythm and stick with it. And he ignored the accelerations and he's come back. And it is again going to be a three-man sprint for the line. Absolutely amazing.
Well, this is a tough climb now. These guys, I have to say, I think Simoni's got to go again if he wants to win this stage. There's the Flamme Rouge right now, the red kite. And Simoni out of the saddle, bobbing along, just trying to keep the gears ticking over. And I wonder what's going through Stefano Garzelli's for stage victory so far in the Giro, Phil. He could be looking at number 2 here right now.
Yes, he won. It wasn't quite the mountaintop finish of this one. Terme Luigiani. That's where Garzelli moved himself into the frame and showed us he was in very serious frame of mind too for this race. And a real challenge. Simoni has come in as the outstanding favourite, but Garzelli now must go alongside him exactly as in quite big time today. We don't know exactly what time checks on them yet. But as they climb up towards the line now, is Noe going to pull the surprise and jump around them and take the day?
I don't think so. Look at his head. It's all over the front end of that machine right now. He's just happy to be with these two guys. These two men have had a real ding-dong battle on the final kilometres of this Terminillo climb here right now. And I think we're going to be treated to a drag strip sprint to the line between two climbers.
Well, Garzelli is the sprinter of the group because he can pack quite a sprint finish, this man, as well as being an outstanding climber. Now he's got Simoni in front. He's now just checking on the whereabouts of Andrea Noe. He's sat in almost this identical position all the way up this climb. Gilberto has done all, and is he going? Noe is looking frisky.
He shouldn't go just yet. There's still 500 metres to go, and 500 metres uphill like this can take you around about 50 seconds. There you can see Stefano Garzelli happily sitting in second position. Noe's had an unbelievable battle to stay in contact with these riders. He's been dropped about three times, and every time he's pulled himself back up. I don't think he's got anything left in those legs of his, but if he can surprise him, he'll have a go. Simone's going to lead it out.
Simoni looking for the bonus. Garzelli gritting his teeth, but as he has done all day there, he's hung on tenaciously, and he's going to take this. He's going to kick and go over the top of Gilberto Simoni. Well, that's a psychological sock in the face for him, because Garzelli gets it. His second victory. Easy, wasn't it, he says. Thanks very much for the lift up the mountain. He's over the line in first place. Simoni and Noe in that order. The clock is now counting down, and these are time gaps now which might be significant.
There should be Tonkov coming in right now. He's going to get himself fourth place. He's lost 14 seconds. That's a pretty good ride by Tonkov, but I think now, Phil, we'll start to see the slightly bigger time gaps. Here's Rumšas with Eddie Mazzolini and Sepulauskas, who did a great job for Silberto Simoni early on.
I'm surprised such a tall man, the Saeco rider, has stayed so well here, but Mazzolini is going to take it, so that's another nice little result for Vina Calderola. Sabaliauskas comes over just ahead of Raimondas Rumšas. They're timed at around 38 seconds, I would think. Now, this would be Pellizzotti, tailed off just towards the top. He comes through on his own. Now, he would be in eighth place. And looking further down, that looks like Popovych there in the distance as well. And here comes Julio Perez. I don't think he'd be too happy with this. He expected to be amongst the big boys. And still sitting behind him there is Georg Tochnik.
Well, this man this year came to the Giro d'Italia with a different view. He was looking to try and ride high in the overall classification, felt that he could get himself a top three position. This is not the ideal way to start. He's losing himself almost 1.5 minutes, Phil, on the first mountaintop finish, and that's where he does not want to lose any time at all, because he's not one of the great time trialists of the sport.
No, and this is Casa Grande. Well, he's lost an enormous amount of time. I don't quite know what went wrong with him. He's done it before in the Giro d'Italia. He's promised a lot and suddenly had one bad day. I think he's climbing up there with Michele Scarponi of Domina Vacanzi.
And that's Scarponi just looking down to see what sort of gear he's in. That's always a bad sign for a bike rider when you're looking down to check the gears, and all of a sudden you realise, yes, well, it is hurting and I'm not really going very well. But Francesco Casagrande, Phil, has lost an awful amount of time, and I think by the time he gets to the finish, it's going to be pretty close to 2.5 or 3 minutes.
Well, I'm not too sure whether it's too early to say he's out of the hunt for the Maglia Rosa, but he's going to have to perform a lot better than this in the 2 weeks which still lie ahead of us, because he comes in here, he'll certainly lose 2.5. It's a fair way up to the line here for Casagrande, and what would he be sprinting for? 12th place. We've had 11 men in so far, so it'll be 12th today for Francesco Casagrande, subject to Scarponi not coming over the top of him in the sprint for the line.
It's a bit of a shock, really, because this man indicated to me this year that he was one of the top favourites, and I would have put him right upside Gilberto Simoni as the big favourite for the overall win. And right now, that has been blown away on the first mountaintop climb. But watch out for this man. I can't believe that he's going to stay up there for an awful long time, because 12 months out of the sport, but with that win today, he'll be the pink jersey at the end of the day.
He's got the pink jersey, that's for sure. Marco Pantani coming in, 3:48, just a little bit less. As he crosses the line, Garzelli, a year on, is a very, very happy man indeed now. Only the second man to lead this year's Giro d'Italia. He's got only a 31-second advantage over Simoni, 44 over Noe. All of the riders we have just seen arrive come automatically now to the top of the tree. Top eight places there. There's the new pink jersey now. And Pataki not in yet, but as I say, he's sprinting and concentrating now, as he will do, on his Movish points leader's jersey, the jersey Tricolomina. Let's go on. Stage 8 is next as we move on now. Rieti to Arezzo. this beautiful town of Arezzo, 214 kilometres, one second category climb out on the course, but it should be a day for the sprinter, I think, Paul.
Well, it should be. We're going right up through the middle. A very undulating course here this afternoon, but one or two pointed places for the King of the Mountains classification, but in theory, it should be a day for the sprinters as they head down into Arezzo at the end of the eighth stage, which is a stage almost certainly going to bow out to the sprinters. We get close down towards the finishing line right now. It's on the front again, Phil, and Pigeon's just trying to get out of the way of the sprint there. The zebra-clad men of Mario Cipollini charging like a mad herd into town. And they've got themselves sorted out for the moment. Doesn't really seem to be the very fast speed lead out for the moment, and moving up there. There is the guy who fell off the other day from CC Polsat. He, in fact, has earned himself quite a bad reputation with a lot of the other riders in here. Is Andres Naudzos. Yeah. And they certainly have been pretty vocal in the fact that they feel that he's very dangerous.
They reckon that he's not riding in a straight line. Cipollini is down there at the moment. He's got the boys doing their work well. We've seen it all before in this week's tour. And I'm not sure whether he's got the legs to finish off Pataki. Look at the elbows going in down there at the moment. That's Robbie McEwen taking one there. And I think that was Isaac Galvez who was involved.
That was pretty nasty. There was a bit of fighting going on there. Robbie McEwen moving up through the outside on the left-hand side. He's looking for Mario Cipollini's wheel. There's Naudzos. And I don't think Cipollini's going to be very happy with that, because he's getting in the way of Cipollini's lead out right now. And if it comes to a bit of fisticuffs and argy-bargy, Cipollini's not going to give anybody the wheel in front of him, because he's got his lead out train. And let's have a look there. Now just obviously losing out there, moving down into seventh or eighth position. Right on the front now, though, it is the big Domino Vacanze train trying to lead them all out. And I actually can't spot there the Ciclamina jersey of Alessandro
Pataki. Just on the bottom. I think he's just on the bottom at the moment. But he's definitely in there as they come around this corner. This is looking more like a Cipollini organised charge to the line, this one, but as we've seen so often, Mario himself has not had the kick at the end to finish it off. He's been close, but he has not yet won. Last year, don't forget, he won six stages. There it is, and he's leaned on Naudzos there and pushed him out of the way. That's Pataki, and behind him is Galvez now. It looks like Furlan might be making a run too.
A lot of these riders complaining about Naudzos, and you can see there Alessandro Pataki was not very happy at all and using any which way that he could to get him off the wheel of the man he wants to follow, Mario Cipollini.
900 metres to go now. The same names have got themselves to the top of the bottle. Bäckstedt is in there as well. I've also seen Magnus Bäckstedt of the Fatka team. There he is, the rider with the blackish jersey on, also sprinting very well, looking for the intergiro competition, I think, out on the course. He's on the wheel of Alessandro Pataki, who's on the wheel of Robbie McEwen, who's on the wheel of Mario Cipollini, and the final lead out is coming. This time, the last two riders are going to give Big Mario his chance again. Now, Lombardi with a brilliant lead out, but last time they blew up their team leader. Can they now give him the run to the line? Cipollini is alert and looking over his shoulder. McEwen is waiting, and McEwen has a habit of hiding till the last minute. Now Mario goes for the line. Here comes Robbie McEwen and Isaac, but they're not going to stop him. Pataki is taking him on. Pataki hasn't got it. He hasn't got it. Paul, that is a win and a record-equalling ride for Mario Cipollini. And by my very quick calculation, I think it's the first time the current world champion has won a stage in the Giro for 16 years wearing that jersey.
But Phil, it hurt him. Look at that.
I'm not surprised it hurt him.
It really hurt Mario Cipollini to get that win. Not the super dominant super Mario that we've seen in years gone by. He had to pull something very special out of the bag there. He's got the kind of sprint that he likes here, straight up the middle of the road. He's got a huge gear in. Robbie McEwen this year using massive gears coming up on the left-hand side. Just off to the right-hand side, you can see Alessandro Pataki in the middle there. The other sprinters, Jans Verrader, right down, grovelling on the bars to keep himself in the top 10. But that's it. That's what Mario Cipollini has been looking for, dreaming about. He wanted to equal that record. But did he push himself hard?
He did. And the seven big names that finished behind him were the best sprinters in this year's Giro d'Italia. And they all finished behind him. He got that one perfectly right. He is now equal with Alfredo Binder with 41 wins. An incredible record to get so many stage wins in modern day cycling. 41 victories now. And he needs one more to make it his own.
You think the fans are happy?
They've chosen to welcome home the big man himself. It's his third victory of the year. which isn't a lot when you're the current world champion, but every win feels good. He has won the stage into Arezzo. Garzelli will stay the leader of the tour. Pataki will stay the leader of this race on points. And Gonzalez will stay the leader of the King of the Mountains. And you think Mario Cipollini cares about that?
Not one iota. He's just happy to get what he came to this Giro d'Italia to do. And this man is getting the pink jersey onto his shoulders once again. And it's going to be a big battle with Gilberto Simoni over the next few days when we get into the higher mountains, which are coming up pretty shortly. But the day, Phil, today has to belong to Mario Cipollini, because I was beginning to think he didn't have the legs anymore at 36.
I think just about everybody was thinking the same way as we now move on away from Arezzo, the ninth stage of the race now, going to Montecatini Terme. Exactly a 100-mile stage, this, and nothing to upset the rhythm of the sprinters along the route either. So this could be the day for Big Mario, providing Alessandro Pataki doesn't spoil the fun. There's the routes. We start in the hills around Arezzo. We quickly fall away. And now the big question everybody is asking, can the big man do it again?
It looks like FDJ have got a big lead out on the front end of the main field there. And I thought that was Sandy Kassar trying to lead his teammate out. And we're inside of 2 kilometres to go. And look at the lead out men falling backwards there right now. Cipollini's got his men up to the front, but they're not as organised as they were the other day. Robbie McEwen's up there into third position. Giovanni Lombardi's in fourth place. There is Mario Cipollini. Now does. He's not scared at all of bouncing shoulders with anybody in this bike race, but he's certainly the man in the orange jersey there, Phil. He's not earning himself a lot of friends in this bike race.
No, he is not. In fact, he's getting quite a reputation about the way he's rough riding everybody, but there's a slight gap here and this might spoil the show. Our cameraman there looking for the riders through the trees. I think it is Sandy Cassar who's gone clear. It's certainly a Française de Jeu rider trying to escape here and win the day. Just catching his number there briefly.
Carlos de Cruz.
He can sprint when he wants to, but this could be the best race of his life if he can hold them off.
Well, this is a young team. They come to races like the Giro d'Italia every year to develop the squad, and they've got a slight advantage over a team, a peloton, which is being led now by the team of Mario Cipollini, Domenico Vacanzi. They are a brilliant lead-out team. They're on the front there, nice and organised, and sorry, Carlos, but it's not going to happen today, because you cannot ride off the front end of a main field when that main field is doing around about 40 miles an hour. There is Alessandro Pataki. I keep forgetting that he's in the Chiclamina jersey there. He's up alongside Robbie McEwen. Isel bouncing shoulders there with Nowdoods. That man is certainly going to get himself a bad reputation in this sport, and you cannot do that.
Well, we had a huge breakaway today of 16. We saw that wiped out, but Fredy González increased his lead on the few mountains out there today. That would make him very happy, I think. But just right now, we're looking here at the whole field charging into town. And they're coming into town here now. Oh, that's Nasdaq's gone down. He went down on the corner. The field are falling off in sympathy here as they try to get round him.
Simone's down there as well.
He's in the last kilometre, though.
Oh, that's okay for him. But this is now Giovanni Lombardi on the front, leading out the sprint there with Mario Cipollini in second place. But right on his wheel is Robbie McEwen.
Now, McEwen, if Cipollini gets it, he's the outstanding record holder. But here comes McEwen to spoil a party. He never got it. He never got it. Mario Cipollini has turned this race around in 2 days of sprinting. He now has the outright record. Unbelievable.
He needed the win. He needed to get the win under his belt to get the confidence back. Let's just have a look at this one more time. Coming into that final corner, they really were going full bore. In second place there, Giovanni Lombardi. But this is where the accident happened. It was now just he overcooked it. He dropped the front wheel. And that man, somebody's going to have a few words with him in the next few days, because bike riders at the top end of the sport like this, and there's the pink jersey as well, Garzelli and Simoni, both involved there, Angelo Pilizzotti, all the big men were at the front end of the main field, but they're in the final kilometre, so they will get the same time at the end of the day as the winner of the stage, Mario Cipollini.
Yeah. Nasdaq's there coming through too tight, lost his front wheel, slipped away from him. You can probably see it from the sky here. What's the man in orange? Doesn't touch anybody, comes in very tight, and his back wheel scoops out those two riders and they didn't fall off. That was quite amazing. But he delayed the big men in the Giro of the first week, but they'll get the same time of the rule, same time if you crash in the last kilometre. But the rider who we are now watching race to a little piece of history, his 42nd stage win in a Giro d'Italia since he started winning stages here back in 1989. Mario Cipollini has done it on the day he was riding as a world champion.
absolutely superb. And you know what? That's a kind of record, Phil, that I don't think in the modern era of sport we will ever see get beaten again. Mario Cipollini just wanted to get that record. Even when he equaled it, he was happy. He knew he'd come up alongside one of the greatest men in Italian cycling. But to go one ahead of that really makes him the number one. There's Alessandro Patacchi. We almost forgot about him coming across the line in third, and Jans Verrada held on for fourth.
Verrada's actually sprinting very well. He's just not piercing the top three places. And there he is, fourth this time. Patacchi will keep his lead on points. Cipollini picking up maximum for the second day, but he's still away off the leaderboard. Alessandro Patacchi, remember, has more stage wins just at the moment. McEwen again tickling the win. Hasn't quite got that final acceleration this year like he had last year. Overall, no change. There's confirming that the riders who were delayed all given the same time. Garzelli still in the pink.
Well, just to come back to that quick thought on Robbie McEwen, I think he's using a much bigger gear this year, Phil, and he doesn't seem to have the acceleration.
All right, well, I'm not sure he'll have it today, because we're going out now on stage number 10, and this is over just over 200 kilometres. We leave Montecatini Terme as we go up to Faenza. And there's a few second category climbs on this route, so it shouldn't be, in theory, a bunch sprint.
It's a very difficult day as we kind of move across the peninsula right now, and it's the first chance we'll get to see for one or two riders to go out and launch an attack. This is a move here by Gilberto Simoni. Now, this is a long way from the finish. We're still looking at around about 25 kilometres to go, and it's not really a major mountain pass, this either. It's only a second category climb. Gilberto Simoni is never scared of going out on the attack, Phil.
Simoni is an amazing rider. He's looking here to gain time on a day, really, when we wouldn't expect the big boys to go looking for time. He's got the team around him. He's hurting the riders. And there's the gap on Garzelli, 58 seconds. He could be taking the jersey here.
Well, his teammate there, Bertagnoli, was actually just in front of him at the moment that he attacked. And I kind of wonder if this was not a pre-organized plan to try and go out on the attack like this. They're not too far ahead right now. 58 seconds between them and the group, which contains all of the major favourites, Casagrande, Marco Pantani and the rest, including the Maglia Rossa. But this is a very brave move, you know, to go out with 25 kilometres to go. This is a man who's looking at winning this bike race after 3 weeks, not on a stage like this, Phil. This is what you would call an average mountain stage. And I think, I do think the group of the Maglia Rossa might just pull them back before the end, because there's only about 18 seconds in it.
Well, there's going to need a lot of work to be done. He's going to have to pull up all of his team around him if he's going to do that. Because, by the way, Nasdux didn't start today, the rider who caused that crash, just to let you know. Contrini also went out. And Brett Lancaster, Paul, the Aussie who's been leading out Graham Brown, he's also abandoned. But we're looking down now on a very workmanlike group here. And the pink jersey down there of Stefano Garzelli put onto the defensive as Gilberto Simoni's pulled off what we would refer to as a pretty cheeky move.
Very cheeky move, but let's not forget, it's not the first time he's done this in races like the Giro d'Italia before. He always looks for an opportunity. I remember a couple of years ago, he attacked on a downhill finish into a town in the rain and put a lot of the big favourites into difficulty on that occasion. He went on to take the stage, and it really was rather an impressive move by him. But this is a very brave move, because at 25 kilometres to go on what is basically a flat running towards the finish, it is definitely a cheeky move right now. It looks like Marco Pantani has got himself into that group, and he was involved in a bit of a crash on the descent. Well, now you can see Stefano Garzelli's panicking a bit. He's all over his machine. He needs to just calm down just a fraction, get this group organised with him. There's 18 seconds between these two groups, and in the overall classification there's not very much between these two men.
No, there isn't, but there's enough. And I think he's going to come back anyway. 18 seconds, he should bridge that. But in the last 2 kilometres though, and it's still not looking terribly good for a little shift of the pink jersey here. We've only had two leaders, remember, Patacchi and Garzelli. Simoni is pushing very hard to be the next man in the driving seat, and he's chosen a very strange day to do it, and that may be why he's caught everybody off guard.
You should always expect the unexpected if you want to be a professional bike rider, because anything can happen. In fact, they've just niggled away 2 seconds there. It's out to 20 seconds now, the difference between the Simoni group and the jersey of the group of the pink jersey, Stefano Garzelli. And you know what, Phil? He's not getting too many friends in this group, but he is getting some help coming through there from a man who used to be on the same team as him, Massimo Coldol.
There doesn't seem to be many teammates left around here either to help out Stefano Garzelli. He's relying on others to do the chasing, or the boys in red here. are really using this to great advantage now. This has been a bit of a triumph here. Leonardo Bertagnoli has done a great turn, I think, for Gilberto Simoni. And Simoni may not win the stage, but he'll go for it if he can. Interesting there, the rider in the Championship of Norway jersey is Kurt Arsel Arvesen, former under-23 world champion, and never been a big winner. He's on the Fatka team here, he's a rider who packs a very good sprint finish.
Simone's gone.
And Simone's gone. And they're all looking at each other. I missed it too. Simone's gone. And Arvesen looked for a reaction. Not come. But now Arvesen himself has decided to go after him.
Well, there's Tirolongo in second position there. Tirolongo is a good man to get in a breakaway with because it means he's going to take a long pull at the front, and that's what he's doing right now. But cheeky move, Phil. Gilberto Simoni will never give up. No. They're almost on his wheel here right now. Tirolongo's giving everything to pull back the man who is a former winner of the Giro d'Italia. Gilberto Simoni on the front there in the red jersey.
A little bit of light rain falling, but I have to say that this has been a move of pure class by Gilberto Simoni, choosing a day like this to squeeze a few seconds out of the race. He's done it to perfection. He attacked on that climb. They didn't go with him. He got a group around him. He's hurt himself now because he wants time more than the win, and it's cost him the stage. He'll get the time. Arvesen gets the win. Tirolongo will be second. Simoni third. The clocks have started now, and the pink jersey is about to transfer shoulders, I think, because the gap is beginning to open up. It's still about 20 seconds to these riders to the line. And don't forget, there's a third place time bonus for Gilberto Simoni as well, so he should get the overall lead. Here's the race for the line.
Well, I tell you what, they're all over the place right now. I can't quite see the pink jersey, but he's given an awful lot of energy. It's 25 seconds on the line, and I think that was Figueres came across there in first place, but that's not the important thing. The important thing is the time gaps, and Gilberto Simoni was in third place there, so he'll get himself a time bonus as well.
It's close.
Very close.
Paul, within 1 or 2 seconds, and we'll have to wait for the official time to say if we are seeing only the third leader of the Giro. It's very, very close. There's no doubt who the winner was, and this is the first victory for Kurt Arsel Arvesen since he won the Tour of Sweden in my record book, which was last year. He got 4 wins last year. He wins this by a second. Oh, Simoni lost a second there as well. So this is going to be tight to see who gets the pink jersey of leader.
And he'll pick up at least 8 seconds for that third position there as well. Yep. So it is going to be very close. I would say it will actually go to Gilberto Simoni by 1 or 2 seconds, but we have to wait for the official time gaps to come through. This group are losing themselves a bit of time. Not a problem for Mario Cipollini.
Well, he's had the last two outings with 2 wins, so he's pretty happy. He didn't expect to win this stage, really. In fact, he hasn't lost all that much time.
He looks a lot more relaxed than he did in the early days, though, when he was getting his sprint spoiled there by Alessandro Patacchi. But he's a great showman, and look at this.
Oh, Simoni. So they listen to the crowd. A tremendous cheer for Gilberto Simoni. Saeco's big season continues. He gets the overall lead. We'll wait for the official standings, but it can't be much. But Simoni has got, and there it is, 2 seconds. It's official. Garzelli loses lead by just 2 seconds. Andre Noe stays third. Pellizzotti, all of the rest are the same familiar names, but the two boys at the top have changed ranks.
Cheeky move. You've got to really be a true champion to go out on a move like that. And even having done the majority of the work in that leading group of four, Phil, he's still trying to sneak away and get the win.
Absolutely fabulous piece of riding as we now go on. There's 161 riders left in the race. We haven't lost many at all. And this now is stage 11 from Faenza to Sandona. And this will take us a massive 222 kilometres. Simoni is now the man in pink. Patacchi still leads on points. Gonzalez is still the king of the mountains. And DiBiase is winning the blue jersey for the Intergiro.
Well, the most difficult thing on this stage from Faenza to Sandona di Piavi really is the wind that comes in here off the sea. It's a very difficult part of the world here. This is probably one of the flattest stages of the Giro so far, and one that should certainly smile on the sprinters.
We're looking here at what has been a fairly big move today out on the open highway. The rain, as you can see, is now falling steadily. It's not cold rain, but it's making conditions a little bit slippery because we've had a lot of dry races this year, and when roads get wet, they tend to become quite dangerous.
Especially in this part of Italy, because they get such a lot of hot weather and a lot of vehicles in this part of the world using diesel engines. And once you get this small amount of rain coming over the surface of the road, it really makes it quite treacherous.
We're looking at the moment further down the classification. Casagrande cost him a lot of time on the climb of the Terminillo. He's still up there though in ninth, but 3:23 down. And the rain is pretty torrential at the moment, and that the rider's not in any mood to do much. We're going through the classifications for you here at the moment. Pataki has a 30-point lead over Big Mario. The two top sprinters ahead of Robbie McEwen, who's a little bit off the pace there with 89, and Garzelli with two stage wins, don't forget, he's picked up 71.
Nasty day here, first time we've had any serious rain here. As we look at the Intergiro, DiBiase there leading Magnus Bäckstedt for just 14 seconds, and then ahead of Eli Aggiano. And it's a very strange competition this, by the way, and it's all basically decided on time bonuses. There are time bonuses for the top, I think it's 15 riders to cross the line at the Intergiro point. The clock actually stops, but the clock itself is not really important. It's the time bonuses, and Magnus Bäckstedt has moved up pretty high there, as Fredy González, the only leader of the King of the Mountains classification since the Giro started.
That's absolutely right, and he's still in the lead ahead of Zabaya. Zabaya is a very interesting rider. He goes on these long breakaways all the time. He can sprint as well as stay away, and now he's up into second place there. Saeco just ahead of Lampre in the team race by 15 seconds. Alessio 1:24. Those three pulling away from the rest of the field at the moment. Now, what's going on down there? That looks like a crash.
Been a crash. Somebody's gone down there. And there's a nasty crash down there in the right-hand side. It's one of the riders from Vinnie Calderola who's gone down, and I can't quite see who it is from this angle, but that must have been a very weird crash, Phil.
Well, I'm hazarding a guess here. I think it's Masson from Vinnie Calderola. He's lying in the ditch. He must have flipped off the side there. I don't know how lucky that is, but he's just come off the road.
Well, it's not a very pleasant ditch to go down into either, and I wonder if he must have broken something there. He's fine. It's always a horrible moment in the sport of professional cycling when you see somebody down like this. He's up now.
It's Oscar Masson.
That was a tough crash, and I don't think he'll be seeing the end of the Giro d'Italia this year, because that was a very nasty crash. They've got the stretcher there, and I would think he'll be finishing today's stage in the ambulance.
Very unfortunate indeed. No, I'm not too sure what's going on. These are the breakaways. We finally caught them up. They've been away for so long, I've forgotten all about them. Merco Marini, Sergi Lelekin. 35 kilometres they went away, and they have swept them up.
Not very far to go either. What a great move that was. On the front end, you can see Domino Vacanzi getting it organised there for Mario Cipollini. But it's a bit of a dodgy sprint into the line here this afternoon, Phil. There's a very nasty corner with around about 350 metres to go.
Well, look at the surface here. It's like glass just now as the riders are coming into the finish here in Sandorna. Now Cipollini looking for a third win to take on Pataki for that points jersey, and he's in a perfect position because he's still organising his team. Looks like McEwen was involved there as well.
McEwen was right. In fact, McEwen got himself right to the front in the corner. Let's not forget, Robbie McEwen used to be a very good BMX bike rider, and he actually decided to slow down and try and get onto the wheel there of Mario Cipollini, but Alessandro Pataki wants it too.
The big three are all together, and Isaac Galvez is there too, 101. Bernard Eisel, a little bit of move up the outside with the Fatka boys, so Magnus Bäckstedt must be getting in the mix, and somebody has dived off to the left of the road and gone for it.
Big charge, and they're being chased down there by Domino Vacanzi. Angelo Furlan is up there as well. He's right on the wheel of Alessandro Pataki in the Alessio jersey. Now this is a big strong move from Tenax. This looks like Martin Hvastija going away, the Slovenian, as we go inside the final kilometre right now.
Well, I'll take Matt off to there, Paul. I haven't a clue who it is, but he's gone away anyway as they're into that last kilometre now. There is still one more turn to come before the line. You can see how dangerous the road surface is. But the sprinters seem to have sorted the order out. They've got control yet again at the front. Remember, Mario Cipollini is now on the outright record. He's looking to go two clear of it if he gets the win again today. He is in a perfect position. The same lead-out boys have got him in line. Lombardi looking to lead him out once more. Pataki has cruised in right behind him. Furlan just behind Pataki as they line up for the finish now. McEwen is also there as they come. Watch that dog on the right of the road. That is not the place for a dog. It's the best seat in the house though, Paul, as they come to the bend now. Still the lead out and still the final jump for the line as they now lean to the left. There goes Cipollini, and Isaac Wendy's taken Cipollini, and they're all going. McEwen has got through. Cipollini is down and Isaac is down. I think that's Furlan as well. As they ride it, well, I'm sure there's McEwen winning the stage. That man has got such bike control, he'll never fall off because he was a great rider as the BMX. But look at the face here of Mario Cipollini. In fairness, it wasn't his fault. He was taken out by the rider from Kelme.
The rider from Kelme just took the wheel from underneath Mario Cipollini. Cipollini having a few words there. I don't think he's that aggressive, just saying, well, you know, it could happen to anybody. But he does look certainly very dazed indeed. And that was a very nasty crash. Robbie McEwen, he came out of there with no problems at all. And there's Pataki. He also was able to pick himself around that little incident. What a move by Robbie McEwen, because he really is pretty agile not to have come down in that one.
Well, Pataki actually crossed the line in second place. He also avoided the problem, so he'll increase his lead in the points competition. Not sure whether Robbie knew exactly what happened behind. He was looking around, wondering where they'd all gone. Look at this. Watch the boy in green and white. Loses his wheel. Falls very heavily. Oh, that's a nasty hit on the barriers there. Furlan joins them on the floor. The three top sprinters down. McEwen made absolutely no mistake at all. He was through. Look at this. Straight through on the inside. He must have known what happened, in fact. Oh, no, he's up there. No, he may not have known.
I don't think he did. He went round the corner in first place, let's not forget. And that really was. There's Pataki. He almost lost it as well. I don't know how he kept it up, because they're going down like dominoes.
And it wasn't all due to the one crash. In fact, they were all falling for the same reason that Isaac Galvez fell. They simply slid out of the action. McEwen, every muscle in his body flexing, powers that bike to the line. He gets the second win of the Giro for him. He looks over and thinks, that's a big gap, as Pataki comes over in second.
What I can't understand, Phil, here at the Giro, there was such a magnificent boulevard coming down into town. Why they had to have a left-hand turn at about 300 metres to go? There was no need for it at all. In the international governing body's rules for the World Championships, you would never be allowed to do this.
No, at least Cipo had a soft landing right on the top there of Galvez.
Well, it was
that
soft.
Was a real thump into the barriers, wasn't it?
It was soft until they hit the barriers. I tell you what,
really,
Cipollini will have a hard time getting up from that one.
Furlan went right into the metal part of those barriers as well. But there's the official result. McEwen gets it over Pataki, Damore and Kalilov. A few strange names creeping in there after the falls. And there were time gaps given. McEwen getting a two-second advantage on the line.
Big surprise there for...
No change overall. Sorry, Paul. There we go.
Yep. No, definitely not. Still Stefano Garzelli just 2 seconds in arrears, and Andrea Noe up there in third place. It really was a dramatic sprint, though, Phil, and I have to say the organisers, I suppose, have been pretty lucky, because if the weather conditions had been worse, we'd have had a few more crashes like that.
Well, we're going to remember Sandona, that's for sure, now, to rejoin the action on the 12th stage of the race, 185 kilometres, but taking us now to the famous climb of the Monte Zoncolan. And this will strike fear into the hearts of not only the non-climbers of the Tour. This is reckoned to be the steepest climb in any race.
Very difficult climb. The riders leaving the Adriatic coast behind them. And unfortunately, the Giro will carry on without one man, Mario Cipollini, who really went down very hard there in that crash yesterday, Phil. And I have to say that after being kept in hospital overnight, wasn't allowed to start this morning.
Neither was the rider that took him out, actually. Galvez, also sadly a non-starter. So that sprint claimed two top sprinters yesterday. There's Cipollini being driven away. At least he spurred the rendezvous with the Zoncolan, which wouldn't have been his favourite terrain anyway. And we're looking here at the crowd. It's a beautiful day, thank heavens, up on the mountain. This is the last 150 metres for you. It is very, very, very steep. And they're talking of riders fitting on quite ridiculous low gear ratios.
It's a long climb too, 13.3 kilometres. It's given an average gradient of 9%, but that really doesn't take into effect that in the early part, the average is only around about 4.5%. It's really towards the end when it kicks up to 15 and 16% gradient, and that's where it's really going to hurt everybody in this bike race.
Well, they're saying that they fitted on things like 32, 28 gears today to get them to the top of this mountain. At the moment, looking at Prusajin here, this amazing man who's riding better and better every day, yet he never wins races, yet he is a superb bike rider, Mathieu Prusajin.
Well, he's obviously having to take a bit of responsibility away from Aitor Gonzalez, who really has not been the man that they were signed up to be, Phil, by this team.
Well, Busagin got away 55 kilometres to go, and there's a little bit of argy-bargy here. Gonzalez arguing at the top of that climb.
Well, what happened there was, in fact, Vladimir Belli wanted to go for the sprint, and I think Gonzalez thought that he had the right just to have it as he was the leader in the King of the Mountains classification.
Yes, because he's been given both the second places on the climbs. Busagian's been clear over the top of them both. But Gonzalez will keep his lead in the King of the Mountains for a while longer as we're heading up towards the last climb of the day now, and it's going to be a free-for-all, I think.
Tell you what,
he's the leader.
Got an idea of who wants to do something special on this stage. When you look at the front end of that group, it's completely red with Saeco jerseys. They obviously want to try and set something up for Gilberto Simoni. This is the kind of climb for him here this afternoon, but I'm sure he's going to get matched very much by the man who's second in the overall classification, Stefano Garzelli. Marzio Buzzeghin, though, he's trying to just steal a bit of glory on a stage like this and hope that he can survive the onslaught of the riders coming up from the rear.
Well, this man hasn't won a bike race, yet he always seems to have the class to do it. He's a terrific workhorse. There's this drop back here, there's Vladimiro Belli. Always a man that surprises. And this is the little chase group now. Calcioli, also ridden well in this race before, and Sandy Cesar. But now, as the helmets come off, ready for the climb up to the finish of the Zoncolan, it's going to be showdown time now. Now, there's the pink jersey of Gilberto Simoni immediately coming to the fore here. They know that there's big time on offer at the top of this mountain. And it looks to me as though Simoni is about to get into the driving seat. He's looking very, very active, should we say.
Well, there in the yellow jersey just behind him, though, was the man who is just 2 seconds behind him in the overall classification, Stefano Garzelli. He knows exactly who he's going to follow here this afternoon. Michele Scarponi up there in fourth place. Francesco Casagrande hoping he's going to handle this climb a lot better than he handled the Terminillo. And right up there, moving up, riding pretty well right now, Georg Tochnik as well. But look at the damage that they're doing, Phil. And all of that has really been done by Team Saeco of Gilberto Simoni.
Well, they want to get to the lead on this climb. There's no doubt about that. And it's up to Garzelli now to form an answer. So too, of course, Casagrande, to wipe away the bad memories he had on the Terminillo and see just exactly what he can do. There's the lone leader for the moment, Busagian. We've got Belli now looking to get rid of his hat, which he's done. He's also ahead at the moment. These are the remnants of the big breakaway as we look at the pink jersey there of Simoni.
There's Belli, and I think he's very shortly going to get picked up by the rest of the pack. He's a great bike rider. He's been around for many, many years. He's currently 12th in the overall classification, over 4 minutes behind. But do you see the size of those sprockets on these bikes?
Frightening.
Scary.
They're the sort of gears that I would go out on a Sunday ride on.
The sort of gears I wouldn't use because I wouldn't want to go up a hill quite that steep. Really a great bike rider. The sad thing was, a couple of years ago he was ejected from the Giro d'Italia when he was lying, I think, in third place in the overall classification for bopping one of the Simoni hooligans on the nose, and I would have given him a few points because it was quite a good clock.
A good shot. Well, there were 10 riders all together here trying to control Marzio Brisegin, but they're spread around the mountain now. Then we've got the group containing the race leader. And they're closed in wholesale because this group was never much more than 45 seconds ahead of the group, which quite clearly now is moving up behind. So Vladimiro Belli on the lower slopes of the Zoncolan, a bit further up the climb himself, and I think he was even waving there, is Brusegin. He might be calling for some advice from the car behind.
Testa della Corsa, that means the front end of the bike race. And in fact, Phil, this man, Marzio Buzzeghin, he turned professional back in 1997. The last 4 years he's ridden for Banesto, and this year he's decided to come back to his Italian blood. And that looks like Aitor Gonzalez at the back of the group there, not really enjoying this bike race at all, is he?
No, he isn't really. I mean, I'm surprised a little way to see him in it. I thought he would have been saved for the Tour de France, but maybe he's here to try and lift his form rather than win the race, because he certainly hasn't played a race winner's part in the Tour so far.
Well, there's Simoni up at the front there with two teammates alongside him. There is Stefano Garzelli. There's Marco Pantani at the back of the group, and still managing to stay in the front end of this race as we go further up the slopes here. And in fact, I think Vladimiro Belli has decided to take off alone in pursuit of Marzio Buzzeghin. He's had 11 victories as a professional bike rider throughout the years, and that's quite a nice piece of chainring he's got on there, Phil.
Well, that's the latest design, actually, and he's going to need all the help he can get on this climb. as they start the climb here now. It'll bite a lot harder than this. 38 seconds the gap as Belli tries to get on turns with Bruchigine, but I have to say that it's not too far back to a very select group here, just handing in his crash helmet there, Marco Velo of Fassa Bortolo, and then comes Kim Kirschen. He wants to do the same. He's the Luxembourg rider, the young rider on Fassa Bortolo.
Daniel Clavero moving up there as well in the Mercatone Uno strip, one of Marco Pantani's henchmen. And it looks as if we've got a bit of control on the front end of the group here. This is Eddie Mazzolini. And Gilberto Simoni just moving back for the first time into about seventh or eighth position. In fourth position there with a bald head on the right-hand side, you can see Stefano Garzelli looking very attentive. Marco Pantani as well moving up towards the front as well.
Interesting that, isn't it? Pantani in and out the saddle. I wonder if he can just show us a glimpse of his past, because this is a climb he would have adored.
Crowd certainly love Marco Pantani though, and he seems to be riding himself into the Giro d'Italia this year, riding better as the weeks go on, and that very often is the case with a slightly older rider. Marco Pantani's heyday and his best days certainly behind him, but if he could do a couple more good rides at a race like the Giro d'Italia, that would help to keep everyone happy. There's the leader of the King of the Mountains competition, Fredy González, in that early breakaway, and right now back in the fold.
Well, he's been, as Paul said earlier, the only leader of the King of the Mountains. He's got two second places today on the climbs of the Fues and the Selle of Alcalde. So he should have done enough to keep his lead overall in that competition, but I don't think he's going to score on the Zonkerland.
This is the time gap now. This, in fact, is Belli closing down on Bruchigine. It's down to 15 seconds right now. Bruchigine, as you said, Phil, never won a bike race in his career, which began back in 1997. The group here setting up for what's going to be a battle. Good to see Julio Perez there on the left-hand side. Lost a bit of time on the big mountain summit of the Terminillo, but maybe trying to get some kind of revenge. This is the kind of climb that would suit him. 15 seconds to Belli, 40 seconds back to the chasers. And we're still
10 kilometers coming up.
Still a long way to go to the summit.
Yes, it is, but we've still got the steep parts to come. This is the easier lower slope here of the Zonkerland. 6 miles still to go to the summit. And I think there's nobody missing from that group at the moment. Noe's there, Garzelli, Simoni I've seen, Popovych, Francesco Casagrande I've seen, and Marco Pantani, Pellizzotti and Tonkov are all there. So at the moment, the key men are yet to make a move. Here's the catch at the front. It looks like we're not going to see it as we go back down to have a look. There, Julio Perez, there's Garzelli, and there is Simoni. Pellizzotti unhooking a little bit there. Perhaps he's going to be the first to crack. There's the latest, 40 seconds and 1:24. I think it's now just a straight 1:24.
Right now we can see a lot of riders in difficulty there, and here's a man who we haven't talked about much either, Dario Frigo. He's just trying to stay in contact with this group. He's a kind of rider who is always promising to be a three-week Grand Tour rider, but when it comes to the big mountains, I think he's a bit limited. He's a great time trialist, but he maybe is just a bit too heavy to get up these big steep climbs.
I'll tell you what, I caught a glimpse there of Andrea Noe, and there he is again. He's the fifth rider off on the right of our picture. He's riding right near the sharp end as we go under 10 kilometres to go at 1:06. That's not a lot, not with 6 miles to climb, and all of the good climbers are right here.
It's not a lot, and I don't think it's enough either, because Vladimir Belli, looking at him here, he's struggling with this gear, and he hasn't yet got to the very steep part of the climb. But he could be setting something up for his teammates, because Raimondas Rumšas is high in the overall classification, and with a good ride here this afternoon there, you can just see Francesco Casagrande in front of the pink jersey. He could also pull himself back into this race, because I reckon he's got great form. Looking down here to see who's been left from the group, and there you can just see Giuliano Figueras has been dropped. Also there as well, one of the riders from Dinardi Kolpak, Gaspari. And they'll be thinking about the position of their leader, Sergei Honchar. And I think Honchar is in the group. He's in a light blue jersey.
1:06, still the time gap here. And Garzelli looking rather sharp today as he moves up. Remember, he's been the king of the mountains so far when it's come to winning the stage at the end of tough days. He's had two top-of-the-mountain stage wins, and the riders who won the original breakaway group is just dropping back through our picture there as they come back into the action. Belli looking very cool, calm and collected on the climb here, giving Lampre a good day out, I think, but not the rider we wanted to see. Well, we don't mind who we see, but I mean, Casagrande is the rider that they would like to see up at the sharp end of the race right now to see if he really does have one win in those legs still.
This man turned professional at a very, very young age. He was around about 20 years of age when he turned professional back in 1992. And right now I get the feeling that Lampre are on a plan today, Phil, to maybe try and move Francesco Casagrande a bit higher up in the overall classification. You know, it's always strange when you get the first mountain in a bike race, and maybe he had some strange things going on with his body and he's riding himself now into a bit of form. They've stopped the cars. That was Belli's car there, so Belli's not very far in front right now. You can see in second place there Stefano Garzelli, Marco Pantani just sitting towards the back of the group, and Dario Frigo not enjoying his day out.
I think he's come off the back there. Dario has lost a little bit of ground. That group is getting smaller as the hill gets steeper. And we've still got the steep section to come before we get up to the line now. Tonkoff is still down there in that orange jersey. Pretty easy to pick out. Garzelli, Simoni. And our camera lifting up a little bit. So who are we going to see? It should be Belli. There's one rider there, and just the one, and Brusagin. So Belli, I think, is going to be picked up pretty soon. Now he's not going to get up to Brusagin, or has he gone past him? Surely not. Yes, he has. So I don't think we saw the pass, did we? So Brusagin has now been passed there as he comes up now, and Belli goes on relentless. So Brusagin, now he'll be soon back in the group, but this might be a move here. It's up to Belli if he can keep the pressure on, because there's no real reason yet. He's about 5 or 6 minutes behind the men at the top of the leaderboard overall, so they've got no real reason to chase him down yet.
Well, he's just going to try and ride into his rhythm, but this race starts to kick up rather nastily once they get out of the tree line. When we get up to the top of this climb, we go out into a very large open area, and that's when the gradient really starts to kick in. There's a couple of sections where it's actually reported to be 20%. There's Brusagin, just a little bit further in arrears. I'm fairly certain he'll get picked up quite smartly by the rest of the group, which contains all of the top leaders of the bike race right now. Nobody really under difficulty. As we go inside of around about 9 kilometres to go. The pink jersey, very comfortable there in fourth position. This is the kind of climb that I think he would wait, Phil, till around about 4 or 5 kilometres to go and try and accelerate away. On his wheel, Julio Perez, and not too far away from him, Marco Pantani. And I wonder if Marco has still got a bit of sparkle in those legs of his.
Well, if he has, and there he is, he'll do it with a fast acceleration like he used to. And but judging by that face, Paul, we might be expecting just a little bit too much from him. As we now look at Garzelli as well here, and there's just behind Simoni, you've got Pantani. But you know, Brusagin went away 55 kilometres still to ride. We're now getting up towards 5 kilometres to go. He's been in the front a long time. He's been passed only by Belli. And it's 23 seconds and then 45 seconds, the two distinct time gaps. Now here's Brusagin, and there's the tempo behind now. He's not going to be away much longer, but it's been a fine piece of riding by him. It's also been an interesting diversion for his team because he's created others. Pelizzotti hanging on the back just about. This looks like there may be a four-man drop-off here.
If we can look a bit further up the road, I think that acceleration has put Pelizzotti into difficulty, into the red zone. That's Georg Tochnik going off the back of the group there as well. And looks as if Dario Frigo's ridden himself back into the group. He's an amazing bike rider, very courageous, Phil, to be able to get dropped and come back like that, especially when you see the work being done on the front there by Daniel Clavero.
I agree, I'm absolutely amazed. And Fass has got a couple of riders tagged on there just now. Clavero doing all of the pacemaking. Garzelli again waiting for the last moments. Meanwhile, up front, riding his own tempo, is Mazio Brusagin. And here they come, not very far behind him now. I don't know whether Mazio's going to have any legs left to get on to this very select group of climbers coming up. He looks very strong at the moment.
Well, he looks strong at the moment, but he hasn't got to the tough part of the course right now, and he'll get picked up in the next kilometre or so, but he's not going to give up either, is he? He's just keeping his tempo going, and at 8 kilometres to go, we're still looking at one lone leader, but his advantage, Phil, is coming down slowly but surely. The last time check we had was 45 seconds. I know Vladimir Berry is a great bike rider. He's ridden high in the overall classification of races like the Vuelta a España and the Tour de France, and here are the Giro. But somehow I don't think he's got it on his legs on this stage, because this is going to be a big battle. There's Raimondas Rumšas, 117. Popovych, it's good to see him there. He's climbing high in the overall classification. And there is Sergei Honchar, number 41, the leader, of course, of the Denali Kolpak team.
Yes, Popovych, you've got to remember, he's just over 23 years of age, and he was first Giro last year, he was 12th, and he's riding right up on the overall classification at the moment, and he's having a great ride. He's still in there, pedalling visibly a lower gear than anybody else in the group. Here come the boys, Clavero still, Mercatoni Uno, looking where his team leader is, Marco Pantani, Garzelli always watching.
Casagrande looks a lot better today as well. They're just alongside Garzelli on the left-hand side, out of the saddle, dancing quite nicely. They're all worried about this climb though, Phil, once we get up to the summit. It's a long climb, as I said, 13.5 kilometres. The average gradient is 9%, but it's those last 4 or 5 kilometres where it really does start to dig in. It's going to hurt one or two people.
Altitude, 1,000 metres. Oh, we've a fair way to go yet before we get to the top. It'll really bite. Belly on his own. Bruce Hagin wiped out. Marco Pantani, is he planning an assault or is he hanging on?
He still looks pretty good. He looks, I mean, it's a long time since I've seen Marco Pantani suffer like that to stay in with a group. And he's actually put a very special pair of wheels on there as well this afternoon. Very deep aerodynamic carbon fibre rim, so he might be planning something in the latter part of this stage. The race situation right now, just around the corner, and it is literally only just around the corner for Vladimir Belli, and he's in front of a group which is rapidly reducing in numbers over the last kilometre or so.
But still using the pace to crack them. Nobody has attacked from that group as yet. They're all so respectful of this climb. They also cannot be sure whether if they attack, they'll have the legs to carry the attack off. So they're waiting till the last possible moment. Obviously, Simone's in the driving seat. It's up to everybody to attack him, and he's just going to watch and wait. Garzelli, to me, is the most dangerous man. He's riding in his familiar second wheel position, and he's waiting for the moment to go. Now, did somebody sprint off to the right there? We need our camera to swing around a bit. I thought there was a move. We'll find out very shortly, I'm sure.
Well, most of the big names are in this group here right now, and just riding there for the CC Polsat team, it was interesting to see that, in fact, one of the younger riders from the Polish team has got in there.
Well, we're dropping back to just check out what is going on here, and now beginning, that's to be Sandy Kazar, who's dropped off the back. He's a young boy with a great future, and he's just dangling off the back of this rather select little group at the moment. That's Adolfo Garcia is the Kelme rider on the back. I'm a little bit surprised to see him still here, I must confess. Concentration there, looking down now, also here at Pietro Capioli. He's got his hair dyed blonde for the occasion. It didn't fool us, though.
Didn't fool us, and it's not done him very much good either, because he's gone off the back, and I'm surprised to see him going off the back quite so early on this climb. He must be going through a spot of bother right now. Garzelli riding very dominantly, Phil, at the front. This is a show of force right now. He's trying to show the other guys in the group that he's in great form already. He's not worried about the fact that he's 12 months out of competition. He knows he's got a very good chance of getting high up in the overall classification. And he's probably thinking in the back of his mind, I wonder how Simone is today. And he might get a bit of help from his old teammate Marco Pantani, because for many, many years those two rode together on the Mercatoni squad.
Just thinking forward, is that once we're over the top of this mountain, the time trials are late in the Tour this year. It's 3 days before we get to Bolzano, and then it's a 42-kilometre individual time trial. So the climbers having their say for the moment. But let's not forget also, we finish with a time trial in Milan. That's another 40 kilometres then. So people like Simone will not feel too happy about the time trials. They need time here. Garzelli can ride a good time trial.
Garzelli certainly can ride a very good time trial. Aitor Gonzalez was in the group there, so maybe he's getting better as the Giro goes on, but certainly he hasn't had the year we expected from the man who last year dominated, or should we say terminated, the Vuelta a España, the nickname he picked up last year because he was the Terminator in all of the individual time trials.
Well, Vladimir Belli here, riding his own race at the moment. Rumšas behind, looks as though he's starting to feel the pressure. Concentration on part Marco Pantani here.
Yeah, but Simone, did you see his face? He looked like he was out for a picnic. He was really not under any stress at all, just sitting there nice and comfortably. He's waiting for the moment, and he'll wait till it starts to kick up. He likes it when the gradient really begins to bite, and he can then start to put the hammer down.
Well, they're waiting. The dinner plates, which they've got for on the back cluster there, haven't been called upon yet, but they know they will be. There's still a nasty sting in the tail on the Zonkolan. 6 kilometres to go, and I think as soon as we hit the steep section, Simone, Garzelli, and whoever can go with them will move away.
Well, Pantomi's got a couple of teammates in this group with him. I just saw Massimo Codol at the back end of that group. And if we look at the tempo of that group of all of the favourites, it seems to be a lot more consistent than the move here by Vladimir Belli. And I wonder if Belli's going to survive that much longer, because he's still only got about 35 seconds over this group. Pantani, every time you see him there in the yellow jerseys, out of the saddle, dancing on those pedals, trying to keep himself up alongside the men who in the past he used to put into difficulty on climbs like this. And Frigo's still there. He's pulled himself back into the group. Quite remarkable.
It is, but it does suggest to me that nobody yet has turned the pedals with anger, and it's a matter of just hanging on. And I think he's done well to recover, but there's been nobody yet put the pressure on to break this group up. There's Dario Frigo dancing there in the white.
Well, you can see here the gap is fairly steady here at 46 seconds, but I agree with you, Phil. I don't think they've actually really started to turn on the gas right now. This is just a question of setting the tempo, keeping it nice and steady, making sure that the weaker riders from the group are left behind. But the fact that Gonzalez and Frigo have brought themselves back into this race really is quite interesting. Sitting on the back there, by the way, was the Luxembourger from Fassa Bortolo, Kim Kirchen.
Now, through the trees, we pick them up again. Nobody's changing position. They're all thinking and wondering who's going to make the first move, who's going to hurt us. Castagrande looks okay. He's climbing this a heck of a lot better than when he was climbing the Terminillo a few days ago. Looking much more aggressive now. There's a sharp right-hand turn coming up round this hairpin. We are steadily getting steeper. Simoni looks good. He's sitting there riding on the top of the handlebars. So too does Popovych. He looks absolutely relaxed, that man, climbing very, very well. A little bit of trouble there for Adolfi Garcia, the Kelme rider. Back up at the front now, we've got Vladimir Belli, this small man who's a real powerhouse. He can sprint when he wants to, and he can certainly climb.
The other orange jersey in the group here from CC Pulsar. Oh, look at this. This is the work that was done by Christian Gasparoni. He's obviously done his job for his leader this afternoon and said, ciao for now. See you later, chaps.
He did a terrific piece of riding. He's taken them right up to the start of the steep climb now. The tempo again has been picked up. Mazzolini becoming the pacemaker as he was the other day. For Stefano Garzelli, and Garzelli, he's still looking extremely good, but he cannot know how his body's going to react because he hasn't got the racing miles in for the best part of a year. Meanwhile, at 5 kilometres to go now, the kilometres are taking more than 2 minutes to accomplish.
3 miles of racing to go to the summit, and still Belli is surviving. We've got a time check going on that 5 kilometre to go banner. Just moving up there, we got a quick glimpse of Andrea Noe, third overall in the standings. Great bike rider right now, and this man has been a great bike rider over the years. Used to ride for Saeco, and over the last couple of years has been a very good team man, Eddie Mazzolini. Doesn't mind doing any amount of work for a team leader at all. Stefano Garzelli looking comfortable there on his wheel. Francesco Casagrande, strange style of his, out of the saddle, dancing on those pedals, keeping himself right on the tail of the man who was a former winner of the Giro d'Italia and a man who was ejected just 12 months ago for putting in a positive drugs test for probenecid.
43 seconds, they're saying, at the kilometre banner there.
Well, I'll tell you what, he's only lost 3 seconds
he
in
has.
The last 2 kilometres, yep. So he's actually riding in exactly the same tempo as these guys. I still find it...